Hey there, ladies and gentlemen, to this Ventus tutorial. In the next couple of hours, I will lead you through all the steps that you will learn the basics to use the Ventus Designer for your very first projects. Ventus is basically a game engine. It's a 3D real-time compositing tool with a lot of cool features. In my opinion, there is one super nice feature in Ventus, and that's interactivity. So with Ventus, you really can create very quickly and simple without knowing a lot of coding or programming. You can simply create very powerful interactive applications. All the shows running behind on that two screens are basically developed with Ventus. And now, without further talking, let's jump right in. Now I will show you how you can download the latest Ventus version and how you can get access to your free Ventus license. Go to the Ventus website under ventus.com and then on the top menu, you click downloads. Then you can download the latest installer here. In this case, it's the Ventus.6.9. Just click it. Then you will download it. After that or during this download process, you also can directly click to get a license now. And then you will come to this overview. In this tutorial, we will use the free Community Studio Edition, and you also can find much more information about the different other versions, the commercial versions here on this website. The Community Studio Edition has some little key traits, or let's say limited features. For example, you just can use up to 500 nodes, or let's say up to 500 on-screen nodes. From our experience, this is more than enough to really create amazing scenes already, even for production. The second limitation is that you are limited to a 4K resolution. That means you only can send out or build scenes with that free edition of up to 4K. And you will always have a little modest watermark in it. Then click here that free button. And I'm already logged in. If you visit the first time the Ventus website on this page, you have to register then with your email address and a password. After that, you will have your card and then you just click process checkout. Then you have to click here that send me updates from Ventus, special offers, new releases, blah, blah, blah. And then click here that button, go to confirmation. And on this page, you have then the last step where you have to click here that green button, order now. After that, a few minutes later, you will get the email from Ventus with your license file. Okay, once you installed Ventus, you have now to install your license. So your license you got already probably. Like I show you here, if you are logged in Ventus and you applied for the license, you click here to the home button, then you can see all your licenses. In your case, you will choose one. I think if you order the first one, you will get three licenses. That means you can use that license on three different computers. So just click one of that license, copy and paste that then into your license manager. Open the start button again, type Ventus and go to the Ventus license manager. Open the Ventus license manager. In my case, I've already installed some license, but in your case, you won't have that first one. So you just have to say then click here, enter license. Are you sure you want to activate license for the machine? Yes, I want. And then you type in your name, company, if you have email address, and then paste that key here. Press activate license, and from that point on, you are ready to go and you can use the Ventus Community Studio Edition. So now we are pretty much ready to go. We installed Ventus, we installed the license. Now let's open up the Ventus Designer. So to make that a bit more convenient, press the Windows key or click down here on the Windows logo, type in Ventus, and then you can see here directly the Ventus Designer. The Ventus Designer will be the main tool of Ventus, which we will use during this whole course, because this is the SDK where you as a designer will do all the programming, the logic, the graphics, and so on. So to make it a little bit more convenient for the future, I right click here and I say open the file location to come to that shortcut. And here I right click again on the Ventus Designer and I click here send to desktop, create shortcut, and now I have it always available here in my top right corner. Let's put it here. Let's open up the Ventus Designer. So now Ventus is starting the first time. This will be the screen, what you will see too when you open Ventus the very first time. Here you have a couple of, yeah, this is basically the project assistant, let's call it like that. Down here you have, or on top here, you can create just simply a new project. And you also have a kind of, yeah, online demos and tutorials, what Ventus already offers, yeah. So if you don't want to see them, you just uncheck this box, but I suggest you keep it here and maybe also download it or just open it. In our case, I just will simply now create a new project. So I click here, new project, then I say select. And then we have here the next step in our project assistant. So you can set up a name. You should set up a name. Let's call it Ventus Tutorial. You can choose where you want to save it. In my case, I think I keep it here on the Ventus Tutorial. You can type in the author, your name, copyrights, a description, and you can also categorize it. By default, you also can set up here a resolution. In my case, I have here, I'm using actually here a 4K screen. Let's go with full HD in that case. You type in everything, then you click OK. Now with the Ventus Designer open, I will give you a quick overview about the user interface of the Ventus Designer. Of course, you have here your main menu, like in every tool where you have access to all your windows, some activated, some not, and more stuff here for to get to the settings and stuff like that here, your Ventus project properties, where we will also go into more details in later tutorials. Then you have here your layer editor, you have here your hierarchy editor, you have the content editor, and of course that big large black window, that's our renderer basically. So whatever you do in Ventus, whatever programming you will do, you can see directly here as the output in the render window. On top of on the top right corner, you have four tabs. Right now you can see we have, let's call it the layout tabs. So right now the logic layout is activated. Let's click the design layout. Now you can see already we have a much more larger render output and only access here to the layer editor and to the stage editor. If we click through that, then we have the animation layout and we also have the data layout. You also can create your own layouts if you want. But for this tutorial, I think that we will mostly using a little bit of a customized logic layout like here. Let's say I want to have my hierarchy maybe here above the renderer. Then I just drag it here. Or if I want to have an incender, you can see or left or right or on the bottom. Just left click and hold and move the window wherever you want to have it until it locks in the place you want. At the beginning, I'm very sure it happens often that you mess up your layout, your editor layout, right? And you don't want to have that. So easy way to get back to default, user interface layout, just click view, then go to workspace, and here you say reset to default layout, and then you are back to at the default, of course. And as you can see here with the workspaces, you can create your, you can set whatever your customized layout as a default layout. You can import workspaces or layouts and also save them. Now we start development in Ventus. To do that, we need to open one more window, and let's do that right now. That's a very important one. That's the toolbox. Under view, just click here toolbox. And now I have it down here, but I just unlock it or undock it now to have it a bit larger on the screen. In the toolbox, you can find all the nodes to start a development in Ventus, basically. They are categorized by these tabs in the top here, starting here with data, where you can find nodes to connect to databases or to Excel worksheets or text files. Under texture, you can find image loader nodes or live source nodes. Under color and material, you can find then your different colors, materials, stuff like that. And yeah, just go a little bit through it. Of course, sound, logic, text, input, output. If you want to control your scene with a joystick or with a mouse, or over network, then you can find these nodes under I/O. Under the animation, you can find everything regarding animations, movers, keyframe animations. geometries, you can find the basic meshes from Ventus, like cubes or rectangles, cones, cylinders. Under interaction, you find all the powerful tools to create interactive scenes like touch applications, yeah, touch buttons, or if you want to move or scale up some images. Under VR, AR, you can find the nodes to connect a virtual reality headset easily into Ventus. Render option is a bit specialized nodes for rendering. Under light, you can find different lights like directional lights, point lights, or spotlights. And under world, you find basically one of the most used nodes here, the axis, and many, many other important nodes. Slides, you can find the nodes for the slide manager. I think this is a part for a separate tutorial. And layers, you can find nodes which you can use here in your layer editor. And E2E means engine to engine. That's a pretty new features inside Ventus 6, where you basically can connect Ventus directly with a third-party engine like the Unreal Engine. And I also think this will be part of a future tutorial. Okay, to start now the development, I will dock this toolbox on the bottom of my window here, because now I have access to my toolbox and to all the nodes, and I can see also the renderer, and I have also access to my hierarchy content and property editor. I just go now a little bit through the basics, how you can create things inside Ventus. So the easy way to start is with geometry, because they are already there. So if I just drag and drop with the left mouse button that rectangle into my hierarchy editor, yeah, then you can see if I go here to that root node, that orange arrow will appear. And once that orange arrow appears, I can release it. And now we already started our first development, because now we can see in our renderer our rectangle basically, right? If I select now this rectangle, you can see here in the property editor all the properties from this selected node, right? The property editor is basically an input and output. All the nodes have that inputs and outputs. The inputs you can change, and the outputs, sometimes with the logical nodes, will give out something based on the inputs, right? Let's say in an expression, the input is then kind of a simple mathematical expression A plus B, and the output would be then the result, right? But more to that later. So as you can see now in the properties, yeah, our rectangle has the size X and the size Y. If I left click and I move that, then immediately my rectangle gets adjusted based on the properties, right? I also have access to alignments. For example, if I want to have the because right now it's scaling out of the middle, right, of the center of the geometry. But let's say if I want to have it left aligned, then I just click left aligned, and now I can do whatever, some nice graphics for lower thirds, for broadcast graphics, stuff like that. If I want to put it on the bottom aligned, right, then we have the same in the Y direction, basically. The next thing, let's say I want to move my rectangle now, I can't do that, right, because you see there is no position property here. So to do that, I will use the most used node, our axis, and drag and drop that in front of our rectangle, right? As you can see also before the rectangle, yeah, just move it that we have that arrow showing to the left side and release. And now we replace that axis node. Now that axis node is already selected, and now you can see we have here properties from the axis like position X, Y, Z. If I move it right in X, in Y, and of course also in Z, because we are working in a 3D world, we have the rotation, we have the Y rotation, the Z rotation, we have things like scaling, right, also here, X, Y, and Z. Of course, Z is not working here because it's a 2D object, so there is no depths. We have a scaling factor all and so on, right? Okay. I think also an important part is if you want to delete something here in the hierarchy, right? You can see now I select this axis. If this axis is selected, this is orange. If I would delete it now, everything will be deleted, right? Because you can see it's a little bit, yeah, a little shadow, right? There's a little shadow behind. That means, of course, obviously the axis is the main selected node, but also here behind, if I just want to delete one node in that structure, press and hold control and click that node. And now you can see, that shadow is gone. And if I press delete now, then only this axis, is deleted, right? If I put in back the axis, and let's do it again without pressing control. Now everything is deleted. If I press delete, everything is gone. So this is an important shortcut to know. The next thing I want to show you, let's go on with, let's use an axis, why not? And let's use a cube now. Where we are here under, come on, geometry. And now we bring in a cube. Now you can see, okay, here's our cube. First thing I do, I make it a bit larger here over the axis with our scaling factor. I bring it up and I rotate it a bit over the x-axis and the y-axis. And now you can see already, okay, it's really a cube. Now let's check out the properties from a cube. Here we have obviously size x, the size y, and the set size. And we also have a nice value like the bevel radius. I think here also a very important shortcut. As you can see, if I just left click with the mouse and drag and drop, I have not a lot of flexibility because the values are pretty large, right? But there is a very important shortcut. Please remember that. Press and hold the left mouse button and move that value. And now I press and hold control. Now you can see I can make already much more smaller steps. And if I press and hold control and shift, I can make super small steps, right? So this is a very important shortcut working in Ventus, because sometimes you really want to make very little fine adjustments in your design later on in your scene. So control shift is a very important shortcut, right? Next, we will go through the layers. So the layers, let me delete this, insert here. In the layers, that's basically working like in Photoshop or other tools where you have couple of different layers, but these are actually 3D layers or also 2D layers. And you can add layers if you press that little plus button here, and then you have access to all the possible layers. Yeah, you can create groups, you can create a layer switch where you then can just switch to layer 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever many layers you have. 2D layers, therefore, if you want to add a color, right? Right. Like now, let me delete this 3D layer now. Okay. If you want to change this color, just double click here and then you can change your backdrop, right? Then you have layers like, let's delete that too. Then you have layers like gradients or just images, right? Or here live video, we will go through that very soon. You can load movie clips, whatever you want, right? So these are the 2D layers. The 3D layers are actually what we had before, right? Where you're really working in a 3D world. So let's make a simple scene where we say we have, we use an image as a backdrop. So this is the default texture, default pattern from Ventus. If you want to change it, just double click here. I already have one picture here. You can also find the pictures out of the web or on your computer, whatever you want. I also will put a link down in the description where you can download all the assets what we are using during this tutorial. So let's use this as a backdrop. And voila, here we go. And the next step, let's create a second layer. And the second layer would be a 3D layer, just a standard. Or you can also create HDR 3D layers, but I use a standard for this now. Exactly. So now I want to get into this 3D layer, right? Because I want to build now something like, let's call it a lower third and maybe a logo somewhere in the top corner, to show you how to create something. If you want to go into this 3D layer, you have to click this little pen here, right? And now you have that empty 3D layer. So let's go on with, let's use axis. Let's put that axis here. Then we use a geometry and we use here just a simple rectangle. And now you can see our rectangle is here on top of that background layer, right? We also can change names if we want. Let's call that PG And this one is our CG, right? Computer graphics. And let's go back in, press that little pen. And now let's create some simple, nice scene down there. Okay. First thing I want to do, I want to make that larger and I want to have it left aligned. And I want to bring it more down. And I want to bring it somewhere here. And now change it again. It's left aligned. That's okay. And I also want to have it a bit larger. And I also want to have it bottom aligned. Right? Because now we have, yeah, let's call it a nice, actually not nice, just a lower third for now. So now you can see it's not really white. It's kind of grayish, right? That's because by default, if you don't have a color or a material, the default material will basically be affected by the default light and camera in Ventus. Default light, default camera in Ventus means if you don't have your own camera or your own light inside, you will always have one camera in the center of the screen. Yeah, basically, yeah. Imagine you are at the point where you are sitting, right? So in the very center of the screen, and the light is there as well. So let's use now a new node, and we are using here now a solid color, because this is computer graphics where we want to show text and images later. And once I put it white, you can see immediately it's very white. Another important property and also a shortcut, you have every node have here this state, the blocked and the inactive, right? So the blocked, if you click blocked, then everything behind that node will be blocked. Yeah, so it won't be rendered. And inactive, that means just this node is deactivated. You also can see it here by that nice little line in the center. So that means it's inactive, right? It's not active. Let's click that again and make it active. The shortcut for blocked is Control V, right? And the shortcut for active is Control A. So this is a very nice way to find in large scenes, hey, where I am. What is this, right? Sometimes, of course, I also suggest you double-click the nodes and give them clear names. Then it's much more easy in large scenes to navigate. So, for example, let's call that LT for lower third, right? And again, if I press now Control B, then I can see, okay, this is my, I can toggle it on and off. Yeah? This is a very simple way to find out where you are. So now next, let's give that guy some text maybe, right? So let's go to the text node and we go to text2D and we bring that text2D under that color. Now he asked me, hey, what do you want to use? A block text, enrich block text or scroll text? We are starting now with the block text. And now he's loading the fonts and now we have already our text here. The thing is we can see it. If I block this one, we can see it here right now. This is our block text, right? So let's bring it back. Here we go. To move that text, sorry, that's something I want to show you later. Let's put another axis and let's put that axis here in front. And let's also give it another color. Let's go to the color and color solid and put that color in front of the text. And the text just simple black. Now it's black down here. We can see it very good, but now we move it up. And we bring it a bit more to the left and let's scale it up. Let's scale it up until we are happy with our size, right? Let's say we keep it like that. Why not? Now let's see the text node, what he provides us as properties basically, right? So if we select the text node here, you can see as the input, we have the text and there is also something connected, right? And this is basically the block text. It's a text provider, which we created before. So this one, you can see now, this is our first binding, but this binding is already made by Ventus automatically. If I click now my text node, here you can see that orange arrow, that means this value has a binding. That means the value which is going here into the text, if you right click, you can enlarge it. So basically the text which is going into this text node, right, is coming from here, right? And if you click this one, then you can see here now we have access to the text. You can double click it, or you just press this little three dots, and then you can see another editor opens. That's the text editor. And then we just can say our lower cert, right? You also can close this, and then we can do it double clicking here and whatever text, right? So another important thing to understand with Ventus, Ventus is always rendering or calculating from or processing from left to right and from top to bottom, right? That means right now this text, this axis is behind this, let's call it lower third axis, right? That means this axis affects our color rectangle, this axis, this color, and this text. Right, so that means if I move now my lower third, this axis, right, also the text will be moved because everything behind is affected by this lower third axis. That's very important to understand in Ventus. Yeah, so it's actually pretty simple. Just remember left to right and top to bottom. That's the processing, how Ventus is working. So let's adjust that a little bit. Let's make that whatever. Yeah. I also can go here to my text node, right? And I also have here alignments. So for example, line alignment, I want to have it in the center, right? So bring it in the center and let's bring that also to the center and let's see what we have now. Here we have to bring that actually somewhere here. And if I change now my text here, then it should be centered, right? So let's call it your name, right? Another thing I also want to do now, let's say I want to create a little simple logo right here. And at the same time, I will introduce you to animations, to simple animations with a mover. So what I want to do, I want to create, maybe let's call it a little triangle, which is just slowly rotating always here in the top center. Let's just a simple idea logo. So to do that, we keep that lower third. Also, don't forget to save. Control S is the shortcut here. And let's create another axis. We go to world and we put another axis down here and we give her directly a name and we call it logo. And to create a triangle, how we can do that, we actually can do it with a circle. So let's drag and drop a circle here. That circle is here now in the center. Let's make it a bit bigger. And now let's see the properties of the circle. So the circle, of course, size X, size Y, but I want to keep it by default, that little round circles here behind the properties. If they are white and not gray, like down here, so this one is a kind of more white like the other ones. That means this one has not the default value. If you click it, then you get back to the default value. And what I can do now, it's a circle, but I want to have a triangle. So it's basically here the tessellation segments, right? So I bring them down to, can see it soon. So let's bring that down to one. And now we have already a kind of a little triangle. And maybe let's also give it a hole, right? And this would be maybe just our very simple logo. So let's move it to the place where I like. I bring it a bit up. I bring it a bit left and make it a bit smaller. Maybe something like that. Why not? Okay, so movers is the first logical node I want to introduce you right now. As you can see, for now we only worked here in the hierarchy, right? So all the nodes we use here in the hierarchy are hierarchy nodes. You can see that on that brackets, yeah, the left and right brackets, also down here, all that nodes with the left and right bracket are hierarchy nodes. If we go now here to our animation, then you can see the logical nodes or the content nodes, they have the brackets top and bottom. So if I want to use that mover here now in the hierarchy, I can't, so I can't drop it here, but I can drop it here into the content, okay? So here we have now our mover node. And what I want to do, basically, I want that this mover, yeah, if we go here to our mover, to our output, you can see something is already running, yeah, and happening. What you can see right here, this is the first logical node where we see the outputs, right? So these outputs are based on the inputs. So let's check the inputs. What's happening here? So the settings of the node of the mover is you have a function, you have two events, right, or two methods to start or reset the mover for different settings. You have a minimum value and a maximum value. And that's exactly what's happening right now. Yeah. So that means this mover is running from -1 to +1 with a swing. That means it's running up and down and up and down from -1 to +1. Yeah. In 1 second, that's exactly what you can see right here. Right. So what I want to do is that this mover is basically animating. Let's go back here to our mover input properties. That this mover is basically rotating my triangle like this or like that, right? So, and as you can see, it's a rotation. So we basically, this are degrees. So basically I have to set up my mover, that he is running from 0 to 360 and always in a loop, right? So let's do that. But first, before we do that, I will show you how you make a binding, right? So we have our mover now in our content editor. And I need to tell Ventus, say, you mover, this output here, that value basically, should drive our input set, right? So basically this one. So now we do our first binding. In bindings in Ventus, you always track inputs to the outputs. So my input, basically the value I want to animate, I want to bind to my mover output. I select my axis, right? So I select it here, and then my axis is also visible here in the content editor. So let's select it here too. And now I have access here to my input. So of my axis, right? So I drag and drop the set rotation, that one I want to animate, drag and drop it over my mover. Yeah. And now automatically you can hover over, and now we know value is driving now our set rotation, right? And you can see it maybe very, very little bit that mover is now affecting my set rotation. So let's set up the mover now. Let's click the mover and let's say, hey, I want you going from 0 to 360, right? And now we can see already there is something happening, but I don't want it going like this in the swing. So not from 0 to 360 and back. So just click turn off the swing, and now it's rotating all the way around. But I also want to have it rotating the other direction. So I just swap this value. So 360 in the minimum and 0 to the maximum. And now we are rotating the other way around, always in a loop, right? So 0 to 360. With the duration, if I bring that up, I can say, okay, I want to have that full rotation in 10 seconds, for example, right? And now we have our first binding and our first animation in Ventus. Now we are going to learn keyframe animations. What I will do, I will use a keyframe animation to animate this lower third, for example. You know that we can say this lower third is we have basically an out animation and an in animation. So let's say I want to animate this lower third graphics, that it's, for example, going out, and on a press on a button on the keyboard or whatever, we start a keyframe animation and this guy is coming in. So this is what I will show you right now. So to do that, you learned before about the mover, right? And with the keyframe animation, it's pretty much the same. So we select our lower third axis, basically the axis we want to animate, and we just drag and drop here a keyframe animation in our content editor. Now, like you remember from the mover, we have to make a couple of bindings. So first you have to choose which axis you want to animate or which property you want to animate. In my case, I think I just make a simple one over that Y position. So I just drag and drop this over my keyframe animation. If I select now my keyframe animation, we need to get access to the animation, right? To do that, we can simply click here on the animate view. And now we have here Actually, we have down here our animation view, right? Let's give that animation a different name. Let's call it LT lower cert animation, right? And now you can see here, we have here now our lower cert LC animation, right? Exactly. So the one way, just simply change here to the different layout, right? But I still want to keep access to the toolbox, right? And as you can see, if I'm here in the animation, then I lose basically the toolbox. So let's stay in the logic view and let's go to our view here and let's open our animation. Now it's here, but I don't want to have it here. I actually want to have it down here. So overlapped with that. And now you can see with these two tabs, we can switch now between our toolbox and between our animation, right? Okay. So the animation editor down here, right? It's one of the more complex editors in Ventus, but if you get used to it, it's not that complicated. As you can see, we already have that one binding now to that one channel, right? So this is our lower cert axis and the position, right? The position Y actually. So here we have 11 dot something, and this is exactly this value. I can change that value here now, and he already updates here, or I can change it here, right? So let's say I want to start with the out animation, that means by default I want to have this animation is out, yeah, so somewhere here. To create a keyframe in this timeline, you can with left click, you can move this timeline slider, right, that red bar, you can move wherever you want to have it. And now we are here at zero. These are kind of absolute values, so let's change that values as well. So over here you can change to absolute values, to frames, or to beats per minute, or to seconds. So I simply use the seconds here, right? If with my mouse wheel, I actually can zoom in and can zoom out. If I press my middle mouse wheel, I can move that slider. So now let's say I want in half a second, I want to have that this animation is going in, right? So let's create here at time zero a keyframe for this value, right? Let's call it minus 17. And to create a keyframe, you simply can click the insert key on your keyboard, right? And if you want to delete it, select that keyframe and press delete. Or you can also use this orange button here to add a keyframe, yeah? At the position where your red slider is. So at time zero, I want to make a fixed keyframe for exactly this value. So let's create a keyframe here. Then I move my slider to half a second. And then I change my value, bring that guy up, and create another keyframe. And now, if we move that, you can already see we have our simple animation, right? So this is our in animation, and the out will follow soon. You also can play this animation from zero to wherever you want to go with these buttons, forward, backward. Maybe if you say, hey, the time is not good, so then just move that last keyframe to 1 second. You also can press spacebar. If the animation timeline is activated, right? And then he simply will play this animation. Also, little hint here. Every editor has basically this live preview or monitor the timeline and values, right? If you activate it, let's bring that back, then you can actually see directly where is my timeline. So depending on the performance of your computer, sometimes maybe that takes a bit more performance, but actually not really. I think with the machines we have these days, that's not a big issue. So we have now our in animation, right? And when we are at the in animation, I also want to create an out animation, right? So basically this one reverse, right? So I simply can say now, okay, I can play this forward, and I also can play it backward, but let's keep it a bit more flexible. So let's say this now is my in keyframe, and my out keyframe maybe should be, it should go out more quick, that graphics, right? So I bring that back to minus 17, and I create another keyframe here. And now we basically have our in animation and our out animation. So these are now the timeline. Now I have to make a kind of a logic, right? So if we select here our keyframe animation, we can see we don't have a lot of input properties, right? We just have a control here. So to give a little bit more functionality or logic to that keyframe, we have another view in this animation, in the keyframe animation basically. So these are the different views. We have the view time, we have the view diagram and we have the logic view, right? So in this tutorial, we basically talk about the time view and the logic view. So now we created already our keyframes, right? So in the next step, I want to give it some logic. So there are a couple of ways how we can do it. I show you the way I prefer. So in our keyframe, I just drag and drop my slider where I want to have it. And then you have this blue button. And here you can say create a state mark. So I clicked it. And then he asked me, what do you want to have, a new state or a new soft state? In this case, I will just use a new state. I will talk about soft states later. So click a new state, created a new state. You also can press the shortcut S. So this is now my state one. And here I create another one. So press just S on your keyboard. Then we have state two. And here we have state three. If I change now to my logic view, right? So now here you can see already some more logic. So this state one is exactly the state one here. The state two is the on air. Let's call it on air state. If I double click it, the keyframe animation jumps immediately to that state and the S3 is out. So give it a bit more better name. So let's call it out. Or yeah, let's keep that state one. S1 is okay, I think. But this one, S2, we call in. And this one we call now S2, right? So if we go back to our timeline view, we also can see now, okay, we are here at S1, state in, and the state two, right? If we click now our keyframe animation here, now we can see already we got a couple of new methods. These are basically buttons, right? So if I click here, then he basically jumps directly to the begin state. If I press next, then he's playing the next animation, right? If I press another next, then he is going there. So how is this working? So let's go to the logic view. So these are exactly the same buttons or methods. Let's call it methods, like here, right? And here in the logic view, you see these little buttons. Yeah, these are exactly these methods, right? So this little green arrow is here our next. And this little orange arrow is our previous. So what happens here in that logic? That means if the animation is a state one and somebody is pressing that next button, then the animation will run from here to here. So let's do that. We are now at state one. Let's press next button. And as you can see, there is also visual feedback. The animation is running from S1 to the in state. If I press now again the green one, we are now at in state, then the animation will go to that to state two, right? So let's press that again and here we are out. Okay, to make that also a little bit more clear, or let's say the colors of that states, they are also very important because as you can see, if I select here now my different states, right, then you can see here the properties of that state. So every keyframe animation should have or actually needs a begin default state. Yeah, we also can call that like a reset because there must be, you know, you want to define in your application, if you have a lot of animations in some complex applications, right, then you want to have a begin state, right, like a reset. Maybe you will have a kind of a reset event or on your keyboard you want to bind every animation to the R key, for example, for the reset button. That means whenever you play a complex animation, whenever you press the R key, then you want, for example, that everything is going to default. Let's say you save the animation in this state, but you want to have a reset functionality, then you basically will bind the event to that begin state, right? So if I click that, then he will jump immediately back to the begin default state. So again, select the states, and then you can see here what type this state has, right? You also can change that. If you say, hey, I want to have my in state should be the begin default, then just change it here, right? And then you can see that Ventus tells you, hey, there only can be one begin default state. So that means you should change that state now to another one. Let's go and bring that to a normal state. That's the blue one. And S2 is also, for example, a normal state, right? So now, whenever you press the begin, yeah, then this is now the in state is now your default begin state, right? I hope that's a bit clear. But change that now. I want to have S1, I want to have my begin default, and my in state should be just a normal state, and my S2 should be also a normal state. That's already what we have, and that's basically it. Okay, sometimes you have very complex animations, right? So you also have the ability, if you click here to the animation, to create your own methods. Let's do that now. You can do that down here if with that little button method. So I click it. And then you can see he creates for you here new methods. So let's give that now a different name. Let's call that go in. Okay. And the next one we call go out. So that means go in if the animation is out, right? If the animation is here, then I want to have the method to bind the button go in that the animation is running from state one to the in state, right? So let's do that now. I have my newly created methods down here. So I just drag and drop them and replace it with that little green one, go in, and go out should be here, right? Because I don't want to go that way back. I want really go to the S2 state because we have a shorter time animation, right? So let's try that now. Let's select our animation. If I go to the begin default, that's a reset. If I go in, then my animation comes in. If I press go out, then my animation goes out. So next, I want to give it, I want to bind that to a keyboard shortcut, for example, right? Okay, so to bind it to a keyboard key, we have to switch back to our toolbox and we are going to the input-output tab and here we have that keyboard node. So just drag and drop that keyboard node into here. And now we have a couple of options. So I want to have a simple Windows key selected and now we have here the Windows key. The properties at that Windows key are very simple. So just the only one what we need here is basically our key, that one, right? And here, if you press this, then they ask you press a key and I bind that to my I on the keyboard for in. Okay. Not enter. I press somewhere outside of that. And now it's bound to my I, right? If we go to the outputs now and we click and activate our renderer and I press the I key on my keyboard, then you can see we get here already that events, right? We get a couple of events. These are the events. These are basically the opposite of the methods, right? Of the buttons, what we have. So these guys get fired. Yeah. So they can basically trigger a method, right? That button's what I show you. So these events basically you can bind to some of that guys. And that's exactly what we do right now. So I want to trigger the go in method with my IT. So I just drag and drop it here. And I say on key down or on key up. So let's call it on key down and press again, select the viewport, the renderer, press I and nothing happens. So why nothing happens? Probably because our animation is not on the begin default, right? So let's press begin here first. Now select it again, press I and now the animation is running. Now we create a second keyboard key. So let's do that again. So just let's bring that keyboard key in again. Oops, sorry. Drop another one and a Windows key and this one we bind to a O for out. Okay, and now again let's select it, let's check the outputs. If I press O on my keyboard, then this will happen perfectly. So that lower third animation I will bind now to my inputs go out, right? So now we have here key down again, and if I press O now, then the animation is going out. So now we have one little issue to solve. Because now our animation is at the end state, right? So at state S2, right? So let's go quickly back to our animation view. So our animation is right now here at S2 state. So that means here there is no chance, you know, because we have not a real binding to tell Ventus. There is actually no way from S2 back to S1. Yeah. So let's fix that now. Okay, to fix that, we have to adjust our keyframe animation a little bit. So let's, because what I actually want to do, I want to say, hey, from my state S1, you play this animation. And when you are here, then play another animation, but go back to S1. So one way to do that is here in our timeline view. I just go here, I select that state, I delete it with my delete key on keyboard, and now I move my red timeline slider exactly to that point, and I click that new state or create state mark. And now you also can see we have the access to all created states, right? In that case, I want to say now, okay, over there, you also should be at state one again, right? So basically this state is now exactly the same like here. And you can see if I try to move now my my state slider to the state two over there, he's jumping automatically back to the S1 state because it's exactly the same. So I now switch quickly back to the logic view. And here you can see this is exactly what we want. Yeah, so let's zoom in here. Exactly. So this is our first animation. This way, this animation or this transition is exactly this transition, right? And this transition is exactly this transition from in to S1. So by the way, if you move this around, that doesn't matter. This is just so there is no effect in performance or whatever. This is really just for you to have to get the things a little bit more far apart from each other, right? Because sometimes it's very difficult to hit the to adjust or drop other methods onto that states, right? If they are close together, like this, for example, right? So that's the only reason why you can move these transitions. Okay. So last thing, what we have to do now that this will work, we have to, because we deleted that and we created a new transition here, we just have to drop our go out from the in to here. And now we can test it. Let's go to the begin state. If we press go in, then this transition is playing. If I press go out, then the other transition is playing. And if I press go in again, this will work like expected. Okay, so let's click in our renderer, press I on the keyboard, and it's in already. So let's press O, it's going out, press I again, it's coming in, press O again, it's going out. Exactly, that's exactly how it should be. To start now with the materials, lights and cameras, I will just create a new scene. You can do that here on the scene and new or control N. So let's create a new scene and let's save that directly and let's save that as tutorial 5. That's all good. And now you can see you have access here to every open scene, right? So basically, every project, every Ventus project can have as many scenes as you want, right? So let's close that and have our empty new scene open. So to start with the lights and materials, let's switch back here to our toolbox and let's just create some geometries here, right? So let's use the axis here and let's use a geometry like a cube and let's scale that a bit up, rotate it a bit that we have a nice 3D view and maybe bring that to the left back like this. And let's create another axis. Another axis down here. Let's call that cube. And this one will be a sphere. So let's use a sphere here, geometry and sphere. And also let's scale that a bit more up. Okay. And let's create another one. By the way, you also can simply copy every node what you have already. That's sometimes more quick. If you just select it and then press and hold control, then left click and drag that down. So now you have copied that, right? And here we just can change now the values, right? So let's maybe exchange that spear with a cone. Cone here. And that cone is now in the wrong direction. So let's that 90 degrees, minus 90 degrees actually, exactly, and maybe a bit smaller. Okay, now let's simply drag and drop some materials onto that guys. So if I use now just a material, let's start with the simple material. I drag and drop that material to my cube. And you can see nothing happens, yeah, because this is actually the default material. But if we select now here our material, then you can see here on the in the properties that you have here the base color. Yeah? If we open that up, then you can simply change the color from red and opacity, right, from 0 to 100%. So let's keep that, yeah, reddish, why not? And this is one red material. And exactly. And here in the materials, you also can change many, many things. So that material node is actually pretty powerful. So if you click this base color here, then you can see you have many different options. For example, no light. Yeah, if you use the material setting no light, that means the material is not affected by any light in that scene, right? But that's also very important to know. For example, if you want to have a very clear movie or image which is not affected by any light on a 2D rectangle, for example, then you basically will change that to no light. And if, of course, if you want to have the very real colors, you should change that to white. Then you have the perfect one by one color. So let's change that back to the base color. And let's drop in another material for this sphere, right? And this one we change out to blue. Let's go here, change that to blue. Yeah, okay. So the first one, actually, I want to be red. Okay. And the last one, for the last one, just to show you, if you use this color, yeah. So the color is basically also a material. It's exactly the same node, yeah. So if you can see, this is a material, and if I track this, this one is actually that color node what I tracked in, right? But it's actually also a material with exactly that white default. And the same, if we delete that, you remember, press and hold control and select the node you want to delete and press delete. Now just that node is gone. If we use the solid color and we track and drop that here, so you also can see this is also material, but with a different setting, no light, right? So if I change that back to base color, then it's exactly the same like this, just with a light color, basically. Now we will drop in a light into our scene, first light. So let's go to the light tab in the toolbox. And we start here with the simple directional light. We just drag and drop that on top of our scene. And then you can see already how the light is changing. So Control B, you can block it, right? Remember? Or also here with that. So if we block or deactivate the light, then you can see this is now our default light. And this is now our own light. So once our own light is activated in the scene, the default light will be turned off, deactivated in Ventus, right? So let's turn it on again, or again, Control B, right? And here you can see now, so our light is now directly in the center of the screen, basically directly in the front of the camera, of the default camera. If I pitch or move now my light via its properties, then you can see how the light is affecting the scene. Now in the next step, we will drop in our own camera. So let's go to world, and under world, you can find here the camera node. So also drag and drop that camera in. And we have now full control about our own camera, right? So if I select that node, you can see we have the position of the camera. We have the rotation, position X, Y, and Z, and also pan, tilt, and roll. And also here on the view, you can change to different camera models. Let's call it like that. Here you have access to pan, tilt, and roll. This is a look at camera, right? Where you can set the focus point, basically, where the camera should look at, and also position X, Y, and Z, and the roll. Then you have the orbit camera, a track camera, if you use a tracking system, a real tracking system for broadcast, like TrackMan, for example. And let's use for now just simply our pan, tilt, and roll camera. Let's bring that back to default. And to make that a bit more clear what that camera is doing, I bring in another node. And I think now it's also the time to introduce you another important shortcut. If you are in one of that hierarchy or content editors and you press spacebar, then you have a little search box, basically. If I type in right now, let's type in axis, AX, and then you see we have already access to our node. So I can just drag and drop it from here now. I did not want to introduce you too early to this shortcut, because I think for beginners it's very important to have the toolbox, because you just don't know all the names of the different nodes. Once you are more familiar with the software, then of course you just will use this shortcut and you say, now I want to have a rectangle, right? So, and then you have your rectangle here. That's for sure more quick than always clicking here through the toolbox. We can see that rectangle right now because that rectangle is now in the center of that sphere. So if I click here my floor axis and I scale up here the scaling factor, then we can see here's our rectangle now. So let's rotate it and let's create a kind of a floor with this rectangle, because I want to show you next the shadows, because you also can create directly shadows out of a light. So let's rotate it. Let's rotate it 90 degrees. Now we can see it because it's flat directly in the middle, in the center of the screen. So to see it again, we just bring it a bit down. That's that it's lying kind of as a floor under our geometries here, and also make the floor a bit larger, right? Like this. Okay. Now I also will adjust our camera a little bit. So let's bring that camera up and let's base it also a bit down. Sorry, this is pan, so we have to tilt it down. Exactly. And also maybe bring the camera a bit more back. If you want to create shadows, you simply select your light, in this case our directional light, let's say that's our sun, and down here in the properties of your lights you have the shadow, which by default with the default light it's on none. So just select this and say create a shadow map, and now you can see already with a little bit noise that we have shadows. So if I move now my light from behind, right, then we can see now these nice shadows. Of course, you will have this noise, but let's get rid of that noise. So the easy way is basically that you just increase the resolution of the shadow map. So it's now 2K, so let's bring it up to 4K, maybe even to 16K. I'm working here on a pretty high-end machine with a 2080 Ti. So there is not a lot of impact on performance. If you want to see the performance and frame rates, how performant your scene is running, you have this little button up here. If you select this, then you can see here how much CPU is used, how much GPU is used. And as you can see right now, there's not 35% CPU. Maybe that's a bit, but that's more scene. Let's see what happens if we bring that down back to 2K. So there's actually no impact on the CPU. There's actually only an impact on the GPU with that shadow, right? So if I bring it up to 16, now you can see our GPU needs 4%. Now we will talk about images, textures, and movies. So I just opened a new scene, a simple empty scene. And let's bring in an axis. Let's bring in a rectangle. And let's make that a bit larger. And now you have a couple of options. So now I want to put some texture onto that rectangle, right? So every texture, every image, every movie needs a geometry where you can lay it on, right? So this could be a 3D model, or just a 2D 3D object like this rectangle now, but you can also put it on a cube. So To get textures into Ventus, you simply can go here to the texture tab in your toolbox and just drag and drop here this texture. And if you click this texture now and you check here on the properties, you can see it's also a material, right? So the material node is a very, has a lot of features, right? So like you know from the previous things what I show you, right, you can see here they loaded now just into a material, the default black and white pattern. And let's go a little bit deeper here. So if I click here this little arrow, then we have here access to our texture loader, right? If I select this little arrow, then you can see already, okay, what's happening here. If you select the loader, you have already access to a couple of default textures inside Ventus, right? So if you just want to have a circular texture, just select this. Now we still have a rectangle, but with a white circular texture, basically, right? So let's use some other textures here. If we go to the loader, then let's use this little star. Right now we have this little star texture on our rectangle right here, right? Sometimes you also want to see, hey, where is my rectangle? Because you can't see it now because it's how to say, these textures have alpha textures. They have alpha transparency channel. That means here you just can see everything what is white. Everything what is black is basically transparent, right? So, but sometimes you still want to see the rectangle, the bounding edges, yeah, the boundaries of that rectangle here. To do that, you simply go here on the top right corner, click here bounding box, and now you can see this is exactly the boundaries of your rectangle here, right? So if you select the rectangle and you make it larger, then you can see that boundaries will also get larger, right? Okay, so this is sometimes very handy if you want to see boundaries of your geometries. Let's go back to our material node. And if we click our loader again, as you see already, you have here a couple of different options, right? Let's, for example, use this gradient texture, right? So this is going from 100% white to 0% white, basically to a transparency on the edges here, right? And now to make this a little bit more clear, I will add another rectangle behind my circular rectangle, right? So let's use another axis and drag that behind. And we use another rectangle and let's scale that rectangle up. So now we have here the rectangle, and now we give our rectangle also different color. So let's use a color and we use here a solid color. So let's call this is our background rectangle, right? And this is our foreground rectangle, something like that. And now we change the color of our background rectangle to something like reddish. And now it's getting more clear, right? Now you can see here on the edges, you can through your circle, you can look through to the geometry, to the red rectangle behind, basically, right? Now let's bring another axis in front of our two geometries here. Just drag and drop an axis here. And here you also can see now, if I go a little bit left with my mouse, then that orange arrow, which is showing to the left, changes a bit, right? So if I have that arrow with that orange line and I release, then he will bring that axis directly in front of both, right? So let's delete that again and let's use that again. If I don't have this special left showing orange arrow, right? If I just have it like that, then he will drag and drop the axis here directly in front. So in this case, it doesn't matter. I just drag and drop that here because this here should be my root axis. And now I want to show something. If I rotate now my root axis, so basically everything behind will get rotated now. Let's rotate it. Then you can see that weird render errors going on, right? And this is happening because right now both of that rectangles, they are lying exactly on the same set position, right? So if there is a movement now in rotation, then you will get this weird this kind of weird render errors. So to get rid of that, you simply drag one or both of them, bring them a little bit in different spaces, yeah? So you can either bring that rectangle more down or back, like this, you see, and everything is good. Or you just bring your foreground white circle rectangle a little bit more up, right? So, and sometimes just very small values like here, -0.001, yeah, is then enough already. And now you can rotate and move that guy and everything is perfect. Another thing, what we also can see here now, there is that white hotspot, right? If I rotate it, it's not even lit basically. And that's exactly because, you know, here we, for the background rectangle, we are using a solid color. Solid colors are never affected by light. But here, our foreground material, so which is basically loading this white circle, still using a material, right? So if we want to get rid of that white hotspot, we simply go here to our material down here, and we go to our lightning model, and we change that also to no light. And now we have a nice even lightning, yeah? So because now it's with no light, that's basically a solid color. That means solid colors never get affected by light. So for now, we only use the default textures, which are already available inside Ventus. Now let's also import some of our own textures, images, or movies. So let's delete this and let's create a new scene. Actually, we just use this scene. So I put an axis, and again, let's use, this time we use a cube. Yeah, so we bring in a cube and let's scale up this cube and let's rotate this cube a bit. Something like that, exactly. And yeah, that's all good. Now I want to put some texture onto this cube. So let's use here a texture node, or let's start with the material, because as you know from before, the material, a texture node is already a prepared material node. So we will do that by ourselves now. So we drag and drop a material inside here. And now let's go to our material again. And here you can see this is now empty material. And then you have down here, you have that material stage, right? And with this plus, you remember before we had here already that default pattern loaded. So let's click this plus and let's say texture default, and voila, this is exactly the same if you drop in here just this texture node. Yeah, but we prepared it now by ourselves with one click here on click this plus button here, right? If you want to change to your own texture, just simply double click here on this texture, and then you will come directly into the file explorer here, right, where I have already a couple of pre-loaded textures, like here this girls, like here this landscape what we used before. If you click here, then you will always get directly into the project folder, right? So if we go here one back, then you can see we are now here exactly in the project folder of Ventus, of our project, right? Where we have here images, textures, sounds, scenes, and whatever you import or whatever you load into your Ventus project will be stored here inside this tutorial. If we go one more back, you remember here, this is our main project folder, Ventus tutorial, and then we are here. So let's go again back to images. Let's see what we have in images. Here we have a couple of images. Maybe let's also go check quickly textures, what we have here. That's empty. So now let's say you want to load some of your own scenes, right? Then just go to your desktop and let's see what we have here. For example, I have here a couple of movies from our studio here. So let's use this one here, right? So let's open up this one. And now you can see this image, this PNG image is now loaded onto our cube, right? So, and you can do that with any image, with any texture, which is supported by Ventus, and they are very much file format supported by Ventus. So let's go back here to our material loader and let's check what other options we have. If we go here again to our texture, then you can see here a couple of options, right? Under textures, you can load different kind of textures, right? Base and alpha decals, opacity, alpha textures, basically diffuse, emissive. If you go here to normal maps, you also can load different normal maps, which you created, or maybe what you already have for your project, which will be prepared basically from your design department, right? Distortion maps, displacement maps, or complete texture sets, and so on, right? So let's keep with our texture here, and then let's go down here to our loader. In our loader, let's say I want to load now a movie, right? So let's go to the loader, and then let's see what we have here. This is our loader, where we can load basically our default, already finished default textures inside Ventus. If you go to texture property down here, then you can choose here if you want to have a movie clip, if you want to have a movie frame, if you want to have a movie stream, if you want to bring in a live video, or down here, gradient textures and many, many other things. So in this case, now let's say I want to bring in a movie clip. So we click that, and now we double click here on our movie load, on our movie icon, basically same like we did before. And then let's see what we have here. Let's go here to my libraries, videos, and then let's say I have here a couple of movies. Just for case of this tutorial, let's just simply click this one. Let's say open. And now we loaded this movie, right? Of course, I still can change now, or I should actually change this maybe not from a, let's bring it onto a rectangle. I just bring in a rectangle and let's exactly, and there we go. Now this movie is running. This is also a little test from our newly built virtual studio here. But of course, what you can see here right now, the aspect ratio is wrong. Yeah, so this is something you have to handle by yourself. Let's go back here to the movie node, or not to the movie, sorry, to the material, which now loaded a movie node, right? If we open it up, we can get access to our, yeah, to other things of our movie node, like down here, if we right click here, the texture, then you can see, yeah, many, many different things, like here, somewhere down here, we should have played in a loop, right? You can say, restart the movie again. You have here access to the volume, right? To the audio volume and stuff like that, right? Of course, if you want to bring it to the correct aspect ratio, let's go here to our movie loader. Here, let's bring that down, the volume to zero, and let's select this one. And sometimes you don't know, for example, what aspect ratio is this movie. But if you click this movie loader right now in the content, right? Then you can see here in the outputs from our movie loader, you can see here now the width and the height in pixels. So this is 9020 by 1080. That's a full HD movie, basically. If you want to have this in the correct aspect ratio, then simply go to your rectangle and put that to the right aspect ratio. So let's make it 60 by 9. Oh, sorry, that's tessellation. Sorry, I'm wrong. Let's bring that back to default. We have to do that here, 60 and the size X by 9. And now it's very large, so let's make that a bit smaller, right? And now we have a very clear image of our movie, right? Of course, here's still the same. You can see we have here that light effect. So mostly in the movies, you don't want to have that, right? If we rotate it, you can see we have that light effect. Maybe sometimes you want it, depending on the application you are developing. But let's say I don't want to have that now. Remember, go to your material, which is doing a lot of stuff right now. It's playing the movie, it's loading the movie. And we have here the base color, but we change this base color now to no light. And now we have the very clear one by one colors. So now I want to show you how you simply can get live video sources into your Ventus scene. So I just deleted the notes from before, and let's bring in another axis, and let's bring another rectangle. And so let's set it up to 60 by 9, because I know already this is will be a full HD or HD ready signal for my webcam. So let's bring that also, make it a bit larger. And now let's bring in another material node. Put that material node down here. Then we add the material stage. We add the texture. And this texture we change now to our live source, right? So under texture properties here, we are selecting here our live source. Now we have a black screen, also affected by light. We'll fix that soon. But now let's first get our webcam stream, right? So if you go here to the live source, which is connected to our material, right? So let's go here, let's select it. And then you can see here in the inputs on this drop-down menu, all your available inputs, right? So for example, in this machine, I have now a Blackmagic Decklink SDI 4K capture board. I also have a Blackmagic Decklink mini recorder. I have a HTC Vive connected, I have a NewTek NDI source, and I also have here my USB mouse. So, and that's exactly, not my USB mouse, my USB camera. So select this, and here we go. This is now me live, captured live in real time into Ventus by my USB camera over there. Okay, so in the next step, I will show you how you can do that, because probably if you install Ventus the very first time, you probably won't have access to your devices. And this is where we are going over the Ventus configuration editor. So let's open up the Ventus configuration editor. You can do that, or you can find that tool in the start menu, and then just type config, exactly, and then we have here already the Ventus configuration editor. So let's click that and let's wait until he opens. This is now a very powerful tool for Ventus. It's actually not only a configuration editor. It's a very powerful tool where you basically can set up all your input, output devices. You even can do edge blending and shaping if you have setups with projectors and stuff like that. But this will be apart from our masterclass. Also one important thing, let's start here from the top. What you can see here in the top of the Ventus configuration editor, you have access to all the machines in your network. Basically right now I have here in this two Ventus machines running. This is here Studio PC number one and Studio PC number two. So I'm working on this one. When this Ventus logo is green, you can see the version which is running. And if this is green, that means Ventus runtime is basically running. And once you are using the Ventus designer, within the Ventus designer is basically also a runtime. To get full access to all of this, to all of the features of the Ventus configuration editor, you actually have to turn off any running runtime, or in that case also the Ventus designer. The only features you can access if a runtime or the designer is open are here these live options, right? So if I click here my live options, then you can see here you have access to any, yeah, to all the available settings and features. Yeah, you can access, basically you can set up your runtimes. Very interesting part is also, sometimes you have setups with a couple of machines, not just one Ventus machine is running something. So maybe sometimes you really have a lot of machines running in a cluster setup. Then you also can access out of the same network, simply maybe with a notebook. You then simply can select the machine you want to connect to over network via the configuration editor and then change things, right? So for example, here right now I have access to my show statistics, right? I can turn this statistics on and off if I want. I can switch the whole scene into a wireframe. I can change machine IDs. I can change the render setup. I can show here also additionally the statistics. If I add here now some statistics, right, he shows me what content is running, basically the audio video input output statistics, right? I have here movie statistics. I have here a bar history where you can see all the processes running right now, and stuff like that, right? So you have also frame counts. Down here you have some AV options for broadcast. You have access to some of the features from the cameras or from your live inputs and stuff like that. So let's go, let's close this live options down, okay? Because now I will show you here all this important features in the Ventus configuration editor. So let's close our Ventus designer first. Now he will ask me, you want to exit? Sure. And now you can see already they are not grayed out anymore. Now I can access them. So let's start here with the very first, with the multi-touch remoting and system culture, right? So what I will do here, I click this little plus button and I call that tutorial, right? And let's press okay. And now in a very second, we are inside this first settings. In this first settings, you have access to interaction, remoting, DMX, and extended settings. Yeah. So here in the interaction settings, you can access things like, for example, here general generate a touch for the mouse, right? So that means if you use the interaction buttons, which we will go over in a very soon, and you don't have a touch screen, but for development, then you just leave this by default checked, because then you also can control this interactive nodes, interactive buttons inside Ventus with the left mouse button click. Under Windows Touch, you also have, you can enable or disable. You also can assign different touch groups. You have access to the Tuyo protocol. Tuyo is basically an interactive protocol, which you can use if you are using some LiDAR devices like OptiTuyo. What you also can find on our website or in the link below, you can change the Tuyo port, right? For cluster networking, you can do the setups here, right? This is grayed out right now because for multi-machine setups or cluster setups, you basically have to assign special IDs and special groups to each of the machines, but this will also be a part from our masterclass. Then under remoting, you also have access to all the different remoting or CLI remoting protocols or OSC settings, right? DMX, you have the default configurations for general DMX settings, ARPANET settings. You can enable or disable ARPANET. And under extended, you can basically find that's something important. If you want to use some special character sets like Chinese language or a Chinese character set, then you basically have to go into this extended section, right? And you have to enable here the special one or the special two. Here you also can see right away, enable character sets, special one, it's Chinese and Korean and so on. You also can find more about this in the manual. And of course, much more settings. I won't go through all of these settings in this course. So let's close this one up and let's say, okay. And now let's go here to our audio, video and hardware device mapping. Let's also create a new one and let's call that tutorial again. So here under the audio, video, hardware and device mapping, you basically can tell Ventus what output you want to use and what input sources you want to use. Yeah. So input sources are basically webcams, live inputs, SDI cameras, capture boards, stuff like that. And the output is basically the same, right? So once you open a new configuration here, this little assistant will open and he will ask you, hey, what device output you want to use? In this case, you have here the choice of your GPU. You also can send out everything what you are developing over capture board, over SDI output board, basically, right? Which we also don't cover here in this tutorial. So in this case, we simply using our graphic adapter output. And here the port, that means basically if you have a multi-screen setup and I have it here, I have three displays connected now here to this machine. That means here you can choose on which screen you basically want to have the output, right? If you play the scene. So just leave that on automatic for now. And let's say, okay. And now you can see here already now we have our output. This is basically our GPU, right? If you have the output here, you also can open this little arrow and then you have also access to more features, which we also will cover in future sessions. And now let's come back to the webcam, right? So over here, you can see all your basically in and output devices, all the hardware, which is already recognized by Ventus, right? So here you can see now I have here my GPU, my 2080. Right. Then I have here my Blackmagic Decklink SDI 4K board, which also gives me here some more informations about, yeah, the name, the interface and on what PCI Express slot it's connected, driver version, stuff like that. Here OpenVR is recognized. You can use a MOSES tracking system. You can use the NCAM system. Here I also installed the NewTek NDI bundle or toolbox. So you also can use NDI inputs and outputs. This null is later on in further tutorials for some special cases, as well as the off screen. Then here you have access to the Stipe tracking system. You have access to TrackMan systems. Then you can just simply render to disk. Then other special nodes or special hardware, VIO, I think that's virtual input output. And over here we have now access, here's our webcam, right? And here's our HTC Vive and here's our NewTek NDI video. So in this case, actually, I have to add here this webcam down here. And sometimes depending on the device, on the features, you can change here. And but here we don't need to check anything, just drag and drop it. Press OK, and that's it. And now also here you have maybe some more functionalities depending on your device. For example, here you can set up the format, what the camera sends out to you. But we also leave that on auto detect because the camera is handling that, right? So also this is the video input, right? Then we have here the audio input. So here you basically have access to all recognized hardware, audio hardware. where you can say then, okay, I want to use my whatever, my default USB audio device or my Blackmagic audio device or NuTek, or I want to use the microphone for my webcam and so on. So here you basically can set up what audio device to use. Here under Crosspoints, you basically can say can set up different groups for audio and can connect them and bring them together. Let's say you have a very large setup where you have, let's say, 20 audio devices out. For example, you want to make a touch application where you show some, where the people can choose what headphone they can test now, right? Then you basically will do this with these Crosspoints. Then we have under mapping, we also can map different input devices to different to different pipes basically, right? So let's close this and we don't save it because that's all good. Now we are going into our render setup. This is basically here the basically the last point in our configuration editor, where you can set up the layout configuration for rendering on multiple outputs. So let's also add here a new layout. Let's call that tutorial as well. Let's press OK. And let's wait until we are inside the settings from here. So Ventus is giving us a warning now, which is basically saying, hey, you are having an ID of 0, but if you are running a render setup with multiple machines, each machine should basically have a unique ID. So right now for this tutorial, we simply press OK. And now you can see already Ventus recognized here my 4K screen, which I'm working on, which I'm recording right now. Down here, you can see the resolution. And this is basically our first basic render setup. But to show you how powerful this configuration editor is, let's select this and let's delete it. And let's create a new render setup by simply clicking this button over here, create a new render setup. And here this little assistant asks you now, hey, how many displays do you have per machine, right? So let's assume I have now a 2x2 LED wall, which I want to control with Ventus. So I simply say, okay, I have 2x2 screens. Each of the screen has full HD and I only have one machine. Then I say, okay, create. And now Ventus already create me this new render setup. I'm also able now to move my screens wherever I want to have it, yeah, based on the real setup. And that's basically it. So let's delete that again, this whole render setup. And let's quickly show you how you can do a simple shaping or edge blending. I don't go into details with that. I just show you the basic steps. So let's assume you have now one machine, which is connected to two projectors, right? And these two projectors, you will have one edge blending in the center of these two projectors, right? So let's do that. Let's create a new render setup. And let's say we have 2x1 screens, right? So two projectors, basically. Each projector is full HD and we only have one machine. Let's create this. And now we have here already our two screens, right? On the right side here, you can see this little button shaping. Yeah. So let's save this first and let's click this shaping button. And now we are already in our shaping configuration, right? So let's make this a bit larger. So right here on the top right, you have now access to your left projector, to your right projector, right? And you also have access here. Now we are in the warping mode, right? Where you can then, basically mapping. Yeah. So this is the mapping mode. And we also have here the edges, where we basically can say, hey, I want to have my edge blending now. Right now, we can't see anything because we don't have any overlap, right? So let's save this and let's go back and let's just move this guy roughly over here, right? Let's save that again and let's go into our shaping again and let's go to the edges. And now we have access to our shaping, right? So now with these curves or with these values over here, you basically can adjust your edge blending right now. So this is, I think for this tutorial, this these basics are enough because this is a very powerful tool. And we will cover more in details of edge blending and mapping in other tutorials. So let's go back here and let's also delete this render setup and let's create a new one. And where we say, okay, I want to go on with 4K, so 3840 by 2160, through 160, one machine, create, all good. And I press save and I say close. So this is basically the, all the features, or a rough overview over the features from the Ventus configuration editor. In the last field down here, you basically can start and stop applications, right? Or Ventus presentations. So let's say you have a cluster setup where you have, let's say, 5 machines and one machine is your master and all the other 4 machines are your slaves. Each of this machine has a unique ID. They are all in group 1, for example. And you connect the notebook and have access to this, or you just open then the configuration editor. Then you simply can say from this menu, from this live project management, you choose the project, which obviously have to be same on each of the machines. The machines have to be in the same network. They have to have the same Ventus versions. That's also very important. Then select your project, and simply press start here. And then this project will start synchronized on all the machines. For now, I think that's okay for the configuration editor. Let's close the configuration editor and let's go back to our designer. So now is the time to start to bring all the things what we learned until now together and start to set up a first little scene, okay? So let's call it our first simple stage, what we want to build. So I will start here with a simple axis. Let's drop that here and let's put here a circle for our base floor, right? Let's call that floor. And then let's make that a bit larger and let's rotate that circle directly by 90 degrees. And let's put a camera that we can see everything, that everything is prepared from the beginning, right? So let's bring that camera a bit up and now let's make our floor larger. And maybe let's also tilt the camera a bit more down, something like that. Let's bring the camera in, something like that. So this is now our base floor. On top of that, I want to create another kind of main stage, right? So let's use a cylinder for that. And the cylinder is now in the center. Let's also rotate the cylinder by 90 degrees. Let's make it larger. And let's also adjust here where we want to have it. I want that he sits nicely on the floor. So this is probably now my align Y. No, sorry, that's my align Z. It should probably be on the rear. And if I play with the set value exactly. So now this circle is standing directly on my circle because I've made here already the rotations. So let's call it base. And let's make it also a bit larger. That. And let's also make it, let's keep it like that. Okay. Next, let's copy that guy and let's call that bottom ring. And what I'm doing here, I will make it larger. I will make it lower. Right, exactly, something like that, maybe a bit like this. Okay, why not? Let's copy that again and let's make also this guy larger and let's lower that again, right, something like that, and maybe bring out the camera a bit. So now you can see we are creating more details, right? We are getting more details into the scene, right? So next, let's create, this is the bottom ring, this is the, let's call it very bottom ring. And let's copy this bottom ring here and bring that here because I want to make also a top ring from here. And let's bring that guy a bit up. Let's say I want to have you somewhere here. And with this one, it's now already over our base, right? So I want to give this one a hole, right? That we get even more details. So just let's say something like that. And maybe we can make this top ring, right? Let's call this top ring. And I also want to make that a bit smaller. Now you also sometimes, you know, it's a bit, yeah, not quickly done if you always have to go to a camera and move in and move out and bring it to the right values, right? Sometimes it's more easy to, yeah, if you could basically navigate directly in the viewport. So to do that, simply select the renderer, press the tab button, yeah? And now if you press and hold your right mouse button, then you can flying around. It's basically the game keys, WASD, to go W forward, S backward, A left, and D to the right. And with E, you can fly up, and with C, you can fly down. If everything is too quick, you just scroll your mouse wheel down, and then you can fly even slower, right? So now it's very slow, and if I scroll my mouse wheel forward, then we can fly here around, right? So this is sometimes a very handy tool to navigate around. What you also can do in this in render edit mode, right? You can basically find it here in render edit mode. If you deselect it, then you are back of the view of your main camera. So let's select this again. And now you also have here different gizmos, basically for scaling, for translation, for rotation, right? So if we select now our translate gizmo, and we select here some object, right? Now we even can move our base here around if we want, right? So, but I actually don't want to do this. Mostly I work really just here with the values. Of course, this is, I think, a personal thing. You can, this is up to you, but for me, it's more handy to make the development directly with the values here in the property editor. So let's deselect our in-view render edit mode, right? And let's go back to the base and let's bring the base back where it was before. And just let's press tab again and let's fly in. And one thing what we can see right now, so these edges are not very round, right? So we have basically to increase the tessellation of our cylinders and of our circles, right? So let's start with our circle first and let's just bring that up to 200 of the circle. And also all our guys, you also can select all the circles at the same time if you press and hold shift and then just give them a new value, like here the tessellation, where we are here, tessellation segments, this one. So let's just put it to 200, and now you can see if we go again into our renderer and we fly around with the tab, now it's much more smooth, right? Okay. And let's press tab again to get back. So let's also add some lights right now. So let's go here to the lights and let's add one directional light. Let's put that here on top and let's adjust that until we like it or until you like it, right? Okay, let's do it like this and maybe somewhere like here. Pretty bright, so maybe we bring the gain a bit down. 0.25. Okay, and let's also turn on the shadow, as you remember from before. Shadow, we want to have the shadow map, and we want to increase here our resolution to 8K, and let's fly in and let's see how this looks. Yeah, this is a little bit a very sharp shadow, right? So let's see how we can find a workaround for this. Let's maybe adjust our light a little bit. It. Yes. Okay. Let's keep it like this one. So, and now let's get out of the in-render edit mode. And the next step, let's add some materials and colors, right? So let's first to organize this a bit more, I put one more axis, and this axis I put in front of all the other axis. Let's put that here, let's put that here, let's put that here, let's put this here as well. And let's call it root, or just better, stage, right? Okay, so now let's start with our floor. First, I want to make our floor a bit larger, right? And let's also bring the camera for now a bit more down that we see what we are doing. Let's make the floor again larger. And now we just drag a material in front of our floor circle here, right? So let's go to the color material and let's drop a material node right here. And now we setting up our material node, right? So I keep it white and I want to add a material. I will show you some bump maps right now. I just downloaded a couple of texture sets basically, and we will set them up together one by one. So first thing what I want to have, I want to add a diffuse color, right? So the default material diffuse color now I want to change. And I downloaded some of these materials on my desktop. You can find these texture sets also in the description below. I have it here on desktop: tutorial, images, texture sets. And right now I have two things here. So I have the diamond inlay and the spaceship panels. These textures I actually downloaded on this website, freepbr.com, where you find a lot of texture sets with diffuse color maps and normal maps. So just research a little bit the web. There are tons of free texture sets out there. So let's use the diamond inlay tile first. So what you can find here right now, we have some albedo or diffuse. I think we also can use this albedo like a diffuse texture. Then we have an ambient occlusion map. We have here a height map. We have here some metallic map, which is not really applied here. And we have here our normal map. Yeah. So what we will use basically is the albedo as a diffuse texture. And we will use the normal map and maybe also the roughness. Let's see. So first I have the diffuse. I choose that now. I say open it. Okay. And now you can see already we applied this diffuse texture here to our base floor, right? Now let's add a second one, and that's our normal map. So I go here to our material stage again, and I go to normal map, and I say, give me a default normal map, right? And here, obviously, I double click and I choose the corresponding normal map. So let's open this again. And now you can see already that we have a kind of a 3D-ish effect, right? So if I change my light right now, then you can see, then it really looks like this normal map or this floor has now some depths inside already, right? And this is exactly happening because of that normal map. So for me, I think the tiling is too large. Yeah. So I want to make them actually smaller. So let's bring that light a bit back that we don't have this very sharp, hard shadow edge, right? And let's go back here to our texture. And in our textures, let's start with the diffuse first. We have here a couple of more options, right? We have here the sampler and the mapping. With the sampler, we basically just swap to wrap. Yeah, so that with that wrap, that means if we scale down our texture right now, then the texture will be repeated, right? So let's, if you put it to clamp, then you will have very noisy edges, right? So let's put that to wrap, and then we go down to our mapping, and the mapping we also go here to the 2D mapping, and we say UV 0, and now we have here much more options, right? And what I will do here right now, I will bring that scaling factor down, right? And now you can see already I scale down that whole texture and it's nicely repeating, right? So let's maybe put it somewhere like this. Let's give it a 0.25 scaling. I think that's okay. And as you can see, I have to do exactly the same now also with our normal map. So I select the normal map here in our material stage. I do the same here in the sampler. I set it to wrap. And in our mapping, I set it to 2D mapping to UV 0. And the scaling factor was 0.25. And now they are nicely fit together. So let's click the renderer. Let's press tab again. And let's get a little bit closer and let's see how that looks like. Yeah, I think that's not so bad for this simple stage. So now we have here our first texture on our base floor, right? So let's go on now and let's give a little bit color and things to our rest of the stage, right? So first thing I want to do, I want actually give some nice color to our base. Yeah. So we have our base here. So let's create another material node and let's track that in. Now we have our material inside. It's white. And let's change that from white to maybe blue. Maybe something like that. Or maybe orangish. Yeah, maybe something like that. No, I think blue. So let's keep blue for now. And this, I'm happy with that, just for that very simple stage. Next, I want to give some colors here to our top and bottom ring, right? So I can create a new material, or I just select this one. Yeah, control click and then hold control and drag it down. And now we made a copy of that blue material. And of course, I can change that now. I want to have this a bit more dark. Yeah, so very dark gray. Let's add one more light that we get a bit of a more yeah, light effects inside here, right? Let's get closer here. And another light I want to use, it's let's go to light. In this case, I want to use a spotlight. So let's use the spotlight. And now the spotlight is shining directly in from the camera in front of the stage, right? So I can change now the position of that spotlight in X and Y. I can bring it up and I can bring it closer or more far away. So firstly, I want to bring it up. Now we can't see it because I have to pitch it down, right? So let's bring it more in front of that stage and let's bring it a bit more higher. And let's pitch a bit more down, right? So something like that. Now it's shining from front of the stage down to the stage, right? Let's bring it a bit more higher. And now you have here also your the fall off and the range, right? So let's increase that range a bit, and let's also increase our outer cone, right? And our inner cone we can adjust as well. So let me turn off here that directional light because I just blocked it, right? Control B. And because now we only see our spotlight, right? So now we have much more visual feedback from only our spotlight. So for example, let's wrong one. I'm on the directional. Let's go to the spotlight. And exactly now you can see what's happening here, right? Let's down something like that, and also the range is okay, but maybe we also can increase a bit our outer cone like that, and let's pitch it a bit. Why not? Let's keep it like that. Okay, next step, we have to add also that top ring to here. The material from our top ring, I also want to bring it to our bottom ring, right? So just control and drag and drop it down. And let's add maybe, let's turn on our directional light. This is too bright now. So what happens if we turn off the spotlight? There is a bit, but I think our directional light is far too bright. So let's bring that more down. Light, here we go. Like that, maybe. Yes, I think just a very decent directional light should be okay, right? Because that spotlight brings already a lot of light in. So next step, let's also add a material here on our, how we called it, very bottom ring. So we select this material again, put it down here, and let's change now this from base color to one of these two lights. I like now this Phong light because here we have now access to our different colors, right, inside the light or inside the material. So the emissive is now black. If I change this to red, yeah, so then it will be very, yeah, emit the red color, right? But if I put it to white, so I think we keep that kind of black. That's okay. Specular and ambient. Maybe the ambient we can bring it a bit to the brownish. No, not really. So let's see. Base color. We do with this base color. Maybe something like that, right? Like this. Yeah, let's keep it maybe a little bit in this direction. Or even with the gray. Not sure. Yeah, maybe dark is better, right? Anyway, this is all totally up to you. I mean, here you can spend hours and days and weeks and months to make your design, right? In the next step, I will add some texture on top of this stage. Let's do that with a new geometry. We have our floor, our base. So let's use here another axis. Let's put it here. Let's use a circle. Let's add that circle here. And we add here another material. And we load some nice texture here. So let's go to the material stage and let's go to our texture set over here, default. And in our loader, we choose the top one and we use here now our star, right? So now we can't see it because our circle is not rotated and it's somewhere here in the center. So let's scale it up first. Here we go, right? And let's rotate this guy too, like 90 degrees. And we have to bring it up like here. So what I want to do right now, I want to get rid of that black, right? So because I want to have that as kind of transparent, that we just have this this nice star lying or is projecting on top of our blue base stage, right? So let's go back here to our material and under loader, actually under texture, we have to change it from default to base to alpha. That we also have an alpha channel, and now you can see we have already achieved what we want to do, right? So now again, let's adjust that, or first let's give it a name, let's call it star, and let's see where we can bring that, right? So maybe somewhere here. So we still can see we have now kind of this effect, right? What we probably want, or maybe not, because this gives again a bit more of more detail. But we can get rid of that shadows here around if we just switch basically off our light, right? So let's go to base color and here we say no light. And now it's much more glowing, right? So let's bring up position Y exactly. And now we have our little stage with that glowing star. So next, what I want to do, I also want to have this star maybe rotating. Let's adjust again a bit our size exactly like this. Let's bring it here that we don't have, yeah, exactly. And now I also want to rotate this star. So what we have to do, we simply have to animate the rotation, the X rotation of our star axis, right? So as you probably remember from before, we have here our animation and we simply choose and drag and drop our mover and we connect now our Y to our mover and we set up our mover and we say, hey, I want that you are going from 0 to 360 and not in a swing and a little bit slower. So let's say 10 seconds for one rotation. And here we have now our little stage with our white rotating star. Let's make that even more slow. Okay. So now we are going to build also a kind of environment for our stage. So to do this, firstly, let's adjust our camera and tilt a bit up and bring it a bit down and looking more up. So what I want to do, I want to have a kind of a environment here, not just black, because let's call it like whatever, a kind of a wall. Because in front of that walls, I will put later maybe some live sources, right? Maybe the webcam from me and things like that. To do this, we simply create another cylinder. Firstly, let's right click here to our stage because then we get a little bit, it's a better overview. And let's create another axis. So let's drag that axis here and let's put a cylinder. And let's adjust now our cylinder. So our cylinder is somewhere in the center. First, we make it bigger. Then we should rotate it by 90 degrees. And I also want that he is standing flat on the ground here. So let's adjust here our align set should be at the front, sorry, at the rear. And if we adjust now, exactly, so now it's standing always on the floor, right? Let's bring it a bit higher, you can see. And if I adjust now my set, right, then it's always just scaling into to the upper direction. So let's reset that down. So the next thing what we have to do, let's make it a bit bigger, and let's also make it first a bit smaller, just that you clearly see what I do. So what I want to do, I just want to use half of this circle, and I also want to get rid of that inner part, right? So I don't need a solid. I really just want to have that half of that cylinder. There are a couple of ways, but I show you the easy way. So we just give it a hole, right? Or maybe first like this, it's totally okay. And then we also have here our angle, yeah, angle start and angle at all. So now it's 360. If I bring that 360 down, then you can see, then you can create whatever you want. So let's say I want to have this 180, and I want to have it higher, maybe somewhere like there. And I also want to have it larger, that we are out nicely out of, that we basically match here with our base circle, right? So one thing what you can see here, so let's go into the in edit mode. You can see we have here that shadow now, because of course we have here in enabled the shadow on the light, right? Not on this one, but on our directional light. So I want to keep that shadow on, but actually I don't want that we have this shadow. I mean, here it doesn't matter too much, but if we look on this side, yeah, this maybe could be a little bit confusing. So a simple way to just get rid for some parts of your scene, for some geometries, to get rid of shadows is only, let me stay here because then you can see it better. So you can see here now this shadow, right? And also that shadow. So I simply use a node called shadow filter. I just drag and drop that here in front. And then in the settings, you can say the conditions. Yeah. So now it's by default, he shows the model and the shadow, but I want to, let's say, the model only. I also can switch to show me the shadow only, right? So this shadow filter is also sometimes a very handy filter if you have problems with lights and shadows and a lot of complex geometries, right? So model only here. Let's press tab again to get rid of the in edit mode. And now let's adjust again our size of the cylinder. Let's make it a bit bigger, exactly like this. Yeah. And let's see how this looks like again in edit mode. Yeah, that's not so bad. Okay, next step, what we will do, we will also put some texture on our cube. Or not a cube, sorry, on our cylinder, on our half cylinder. So let's do that. Let's use material. And let's drag and drop that material in. And now let's go to add a material stage. And here I want to use another diffuse. And this is now our default. As you can see, the black and white pattern already a little bit. Of course, we have a kind of less light here behind because of our, we played around with our directional light, right? And there are also some reflections. But anyway, let's go on. It will be more clear soon. So we have now here our texture loader, double click it, and let's add here our albedo and open that. Okay, now you can see a bit of structure already. Then let's go on and let's add another one. And here we add our another texture stage, and here we add our normal map. This is by default. Okay, and here we also load now the corresponding normal map from this texture set, right? That's spaceship panels. Let's open this, and now we can see already we get a kind of more structure. Right now it's a bit distorted because you know, it's not a squared rectangle, right? Because it's a half circle basically and curved. So let's do what we did before with our floor. We start here with our normal map, and we change from our simple to clamp to wrap, and in our mapping we change it to our 2D mapping UV, because I want to have control over that mapping right now, right? And in this case, I just want to control that scaling. I want to make that a bit smaller, that until I like it, right? You also can scale it in the other direction or make it larger. So maybe let's keep it like that, and let's give them some nice values, because we also have to copy these values into our albedo map, right? So let's say here we have 0.15, and here we take 1.5. And let's do now give the same values in our diffuse albedo map. Or let's go here. Let's change that to simple wrap. And from simple to 2D UV 0. And the X was 0.15. And the Y was 1.5. Right? And now actually, is that right what I do? Let me see again. Double check. Scaling X and Y, 0.15. Okay. Okay, I changed the position here. So I was wrong. So again, 0.15 and 1.5. And now they should match together, right? And also here, we can now play around with colors. Yeah? So we still have the base color here. Let's change that to this other light. Or let's try our Fong light. Let's maybe, is not that bad here. And let's see what happens if we move our directional light. So now you can already see we have for sure that light effects on our backdrop wall, right? So now let's also add some, let's put some person on top of this stage, right? So this one here was our, let's call that BG wall. And let's also bring that together. So I want to have now some person standing here, right? So we add another axis and we add a simple rectangle and let's add the material because we have to load a texture. And to do that, we are adding a material stage. And here I want to add now a base plus alpha, yeah, because the texture I will load now has an alpha channel because I just want to see the person basically. So let's select that, double click, and then let's find in our project. As you can see right now, we are not in our project, right? Because before I navigated out here with that file explorer. If you want to get back to your project, just simply press here project, and then you are back in your project folder, right? So let's use here now maybe this girl, or what about this one? Maybe this one. Let's use this girl. And now let's see where we are. So let's scale up first our rectangle. Here we go. And now we have here our girl already. And you can see already there is an alpha channel in this image. So one thing what we have to know now, we have to put the rectangle to the right size, because if we just leave it like that, you can see the aspect ratio is not correct. So one way you can do it, that if you just simply once you are loading your image, right? If you just select that picture, then you can find here your aspect ratio 1830 by 3431, and then just write that down or copy that into your rectangle. Yeah, that you have basically the same aspect ratio. Or you also can change here your loader to a texture property, basically here to a texture loader, and then you will get here this texture loader. And this texture loader, now we have to reload this picture again, but that's quickly done. We just do that here, press this button, select this girl and press open. And now we also get here the values, the width and the height of our image, right? So because from here, it's now a bit easy to change. So just, I think we cannot double click here. So let's go to the rectangle and let's put that to 30, right? Let's double check it again. 1830 and 3431. 431. And now we have basically the correct aspect ratio of the picture, right? So let's make it a bit smaller. And let's also bring that girl up, that she's standing flat and nicely on that stage. Again, a bit smaller. And bring her down here. And what we also don't want, actually, I mean, now we can try to play with the light, right? Because now, you know, this material is still affected by light. So we have a couple of options here. We just can say, hey, I don't want that this image get affected by light. So I simply turn the light off here, or I keep it maybe as the base color. And let's put another spotlight, or let's play with this spotlight and try to pitch that a bit more to her. But then you can also see then we get that blending effect. So that's also not what I want. So I think the best thing what we can do here is simply turn off the light, that we have the full color, so no light. And let's bring that girl a bit more to the front. And let's also swap it a bit to here. And let's make it smaller. Somewhere here. And let's see where we are. And you can see also in this case, it would be very helpful if you open the bounding box, because then you can see the boundaries and then you can see directly, okay, there are basically the bottom where she should stand. Another thing what I also want to have right now, I actually will show you how you can create a shadow from this image. So to get the shadows, we simply have to turn on the shadows in our spotlight, because the spotlight is now the main light, which is also shining onto the girl. So let's go to the spotlight and let's go down to shadow. And down here we say a shadow map. And now we can see already we get a shadow, but we get a shadow actually from this full rectangle what we have, right? So this is now the whole rectangle is throwing a shadow, but that's not what we want. So to change that, we go to our material here. And over here, you have a couple of other options. Here we have our standard properties, and over here you have the shadow options. So under shadow options, you simply change from shadow options inherit to shadow options, and then you turn off simple caster shadow, right? And now you can see already, let's also turn off the bounding box. And if I go into the scene now, now you can see already we have here our nice shadow from that girl, right? So now we have to make maybe a couple of little fine tunings, like that star is a bit too bright. So this is where we are. This is on our stage, and here we have our star. So I just decrease the opacity of that star a bit, maybe like this. And let's also give it a different color, maybe some yellowish. Yeah, and maybe also increase the opacity a bit, something like that. So in the next step, I will create a screen. And on the screen, we can drop then a movie and a live source, whatever we want. So let's do that right now. So let's bring that, make that smaller. And let's give here, this is our girl. And also, let's right click here. So it's out of the way. Okay, so I create another axis. I create a rectangle. And I create a texture or a material. You remember, a texture is a material with already one material stage. So select this and let's change our loader to our live video. And then under our live video, first let's make it larger that we can see it, because it's always stuck in there in the middle right now. See? So let's see what we are doing here right now. Let's bring it up. It's black. So let's go here and let's go to our live video and let's change that to our webcam. So now we can see something is very wrong right there. So what happened there? So we have first, we have a square, right? But you can see me, I'm already here. First thing I want to change, our light to no light. And we have the full color. Then let's bring us a bit here in front. And let's change quickly here our aspect ratio and the rectangle. So we have 1.6 to 0.9, 60 by 9 basically. And let's make that smaller and whatever, let's put us somewhere behind that stage, somewhere here on the left side, and maybe a bit larger, and let's rotate us as well, maybe something like that, and a bit up, exactly. And now we are here with this one. You can build now Zoom meetings with different live sources. So as you can see, Ventus is very, very powerful. Or also that girl could be now, for example, from a green screen, can stand live in front of a green screen, and you can do the keying, and then some live person can stand on this stage, for example, with live shadow, as you can see. So Ventus is very powerful here to create really a variety of applications, for live shows, for events, for simple touch applications. Now we will add also some nice feature. Let's add a lower cert. We did that in this course before already. Let's do that. So this is my live cam. And let's close that down and let's add an axis. And let's add a rounded rectangle because that's something we didn't use yet. So let's scale that up. Let's bring it here. Here we have our rounded rectangle and we bring it a bit more into the front and we bring it a bit more up and also a bit smaller again and a bit more down. So here are many ways, you know, how you can change this. Now we already have this nice shadow. Can keep, why not? And let's create now a kind of a lower cert, right? So let's call that LT for lower cert. And let's give this guy a color. And we use here a solid color. And we keep it, see, maybe we keep it kind of orange. Yeah. And we bring that a bit more down. And add some text, right? So let's simply add another axis down here. And here we add then a text node. Text 2D is okay. Let's use the block text. Now we have here already our text. So let's adjust this. Let's see what we can do with our text node. So I want to have the line text alignment should be center. That's good. And our line alignment should be center as well. And now I adjust the scaling, maybe a bit smaller. Let's put another axis. And let's, no axis, sorry. Let's put another color and white is good. So now we see we have to bring it a bit in front that they are in different spaces, right? And maybe a bit smaller. And now you can type in a text here. Let's go here and let's go to find our text. Here's our text node. And here we call it the girl, right? So here you can put whatever you want. In our next tutorial, we will also show, or I will also show how you can bind text and content, how you can fetch this, grab it directly out of Excel sheets that you keep very flexible, that you can run your live shows and stuff like that. So, but for now, we just keep it simple. Another thing I want to do, I want to animate this also. So what I want to do, I want, for example, that this lower third is coming in from left to right like this, and that it's going out to the right, something like that, on a press on a button. So to do this animation, we select our lower third axis and we are simply drag and drop the keyframe animation into our content editor. And as you remember, just drag and drop any property onto your animation. In that case, we keep it simple. We just want to make this animation coming in, going out, right? So we just drag and drop that X position to our animation. Then we select our animation and we have down here already our animation view, right? If you don't have that, remember, go to view and just select this animation. Here it's activated already. That's all good. You also can change here to your animate view and then you have only access here to your animation. But we keep going here in our logic view, which we already customized a bit for us. So now in our animation view, we are going here to our time view. And remember, middle mouse button, you can move that whole thing. You can zoom in and zoom out. We change it here to 1 second. And we have a bit more clearer overview. And let's say we start when with the out animation, right? So at the beginning, I don't want to see this this lower third. So that means I just bring that out at time zero, somewhere here, that also the shadow is disappeared, right? So somewhere to, let's call it minus 20, exactly, it's there already. And then we just add a keyframe at time zero. Okay, let's do that. After, let's say 1 second, I want that this lower third is in on position zero and we add another keyframe. After that, I want to say after half a second, I want that this lower third is out at probably 20, right? Like on the left side. And let's add another keyframe. And now if we press space and we run it in and out, that's exactly what we want. Now you remember we have to create our logic. So let's do that here too. I add a state here, I create a state mark. I create my new state here or just press S. And here I create another state mark. I press S now on my keyboard. And here I want to reuse again the same state. You remember that we can always run from the beginning. So to do that, we set our red bar to the end and we select this one and we say, okay, you are also state one, right? So now it's going in and it's going out. Actually, it's now not what I really want because now he's going back to that direction, right? But I want that he's going out to the right direction. So to do that, to fix that, let's delete this state again and let's add this. So 20. So what we have to do here, we actually have to use soft states, yeah, because a soft state can have different values at different states or at different times, right? So to do that, we select also this one, the S2 we can keep, but instead here creating a normal hard state, what we do if we press just S or this new state, we create a soft state. So this is now our state 3. We can double click here, can we? No, we cannot. So now I swept with a shortcut somewhere in our view. So let's go back here because with that shortcut D, I swept here in our diagram view. So let's go back here. I want to change these names now because I just need two states, our out state and our in state, right? So let's change that name here in our logic view. So here we have now our state 2 is in and this is out. So the state 1 we don't need anymore. So let's make it like this. State 3 is out. Let's double click here and this one we call out. And this state we double click and we call that in, right? And as you also remember, we always should have a begin default state for kind of reset issues, which I will show you also later. So select the state and we change the type here from end default to begin default. And the in state is just a normal state, right? So, and now let's go back to our time view. And now we have now our out, our in, and here's again our out. And now let's create that out state here again. Now it should work because now we have a soft state, right? So let's create out and let's see. And now it's exactly like expected. We are going in from here and we are going out to there. If we see that again, Ventus created here a second transition, right? Which is not this transition. This is the transition where basically from the in state, where then the transition is going out to the right. Okay, let's also give this a bit of a logic. The states we have already, but now we also should create a little bit more clearer methods here, right? Because right now we see with our next method here, begin, with our next method we are going here, and with our other next method we are going there. That's actually not that bad because I actually want to bind all this to only one key, right? So let's say this lower third, I want if I press my key 1 on the keyboard, then he should come in if it's not in. And if I press the key 1 again, then he should go out if it's visible, right? So basically what I want to do, if I press key 1, this should happen. If I press key 1 again, then this should happen. If I press key 1 again, this should happen, and so on, right? So let's do that. Let's simply put here in our content editor a Windows key. Let's drag and drop that in. And then we simply assign here our key 1. Select this key, press 1, and here we go. Now our keyboard key 1 is activated. And now we just have to connect our next method to our Windows key. And we want to trigger that on key down, right? If we select now our viewpoint and we press 1, then the lower third is coming in, going on, in, out. So we basically can toggle now with our keyboard key 1, our lower third. So next step, let's also do the same for our live cam, right? Because I want to have a bit more of flexibility where I say, hey, I want to have, I want to have the live picture, or I don't want to have it. And we will bind that on our Windows key too. There are a couple of ways to do. We can decide, we can bring it from up to down, or we also can use some transparency. So the material in this case would have the value opacity. So if we animate this opacity, then we just fade this in and fade this out, right? So this is totally up to us. I think I like it more to have also a bit of movement. So I just will animate now here our Y axis. So here our live picture is out, and I want to bring it back in over the Y position, right? So let's do that by simply again, go to our toolbox and drag and drop a keyframe animation. And we bind here our Y position to our animation. And we go back to our animation and we go here to our time view. And here we say, okay, first I want to have it out. So insert a keyframe. And after 1 second, I want that it's in. So let's bring it to a position where we like it. Insert another keyframe. And after half a second, I want to have it out again. And insert another keyframe. And now let's create our states. Remember, this state and this state should be the same that we can run in this loop, right? So this state has to be a soft state. So we create here a new soft state. And we create here a new soft state or a hard state. So here it doesn't matter actually. So let's create here just a simple state. And over here, we just reuse this state one again, right? So S1 is here again. And now we can see we are going in and we are going out in half a second, okay? So now let's check the logic. And as you can see here, Ventus is already clever and knows and created our transitions already for us. So if we go now here to our animation, and we bring it in, then the animation is coming in and it's going out more quick, coming in slowly, going out quick. So last thing again here, let's create a Windows key again, see already, and let's assign that to our keyboard key 2. And we bind our next method to our Windows key 2, key down. Now let's select here the renderer and let's see if this works. We are bringing live input in and it's going out. Key one brings in the lower third and so on, right? So now we have already a bit of flexibility, functionality here in our scene. Another thing I want to do, as you can imagine with these animations, we can basically animate any value. So what I want to do, I want to have kind of different camera positions. Yeah. So for example, let's say I want to have a kind of a wide shot. Let's try that. Where I have, here the girl and also maybe here our lower third and our live image. But I want to have as well, maybe a more close up, right? So maybe somewhere here and still have here my live input. And maybe I also can say, or we can do that. I also want to have a kind of a larger view or zoom view of our live input, right? Where we even have to move the camera then a little bit, something like that. So this is what we will do right now. So to do that, let's start with somewhere with a default position, right? With our start position, let's bring the X to the center. Let's bring that a bit more down. Also our pan should be on 0. And where we are here now, position Y. Also, I think this was a kind of our start position, right? So let's go to our camera. Let's select our camera and let's drag in a new animation, a new keyframe animation. Let's drag and drop that here. And let's see what values we need to animate, right? So we probably need to animate our position X, drag and drop it, our position Y, and also our position Z, and probably also our pan and tilt. So here we have now already a multi-channel keyframe animation. So let's select the animation and let's go down here into our animation view. And here we can see now all the assigned or connected or binded values, right? So let's go to our timeline view. And in our timeline view, first thing what we do, this should be our one of our positions. So let's do that and let's create a keyframe here. Then we going to, after maybe 2 seconds, I want to have another position. Yeah. So let's see, position X is okay, but let's say I want to have this then higher and a bit more close up. Maybe somewhere here. It's also down. Let's say maybe something like this, and let's create another one. And now, as you can see, as we drag and drop here our timeline, we already have this first animation, right? So this is one way how you can do it, creating states by state by state. Another thing, what you also can do, let's firstly bring that back, and now we delete all these channels. You can also set up in a different way your keyframe animation. So to do this, we are going here to our logic view, and in our logic view, we just double click, and now we have a state. Yeah, with a double click here in the logic view, you are creating a state. So, and this state one is our, let's call it position one. Then we say this is exactly, this should be our position one, right? Then we double click again. And here we call it position two. And now with this activated, we can change now our values here, right? And if I change this to here and I go back to our position and I go double click back to here, then this states already saved these positions. Okay. So let's now adjust this. The X value, I think zero is okay. Let's make this just a close up of our girl here, right? So maybe like this, and we tilt it a bit down, something like that. Why not? So this is now our position two, and this is our position one. Okay. Now let's create a third one. So just double click somewhere in the empty areas here, and let's give it a name directly. And this is our position three. And with this selected, we are wanting to go. Where do we want to go? Let's say we want to have a close up from our live view, right? So let's do that. So we go closer, but not to this way. And we bring this a bit up, and we are going closer, and we also have to pan it to the left, and we have to tilt it a bit up, and this pan was a bit too much, and also like this, and a bit to the left, and maybe a bit more down, something like that. Not perfect, but it's okay. So now we have these positions, position one, position two, and position three, right? So now we have to make connections. So this is also kind of logic. In the best case, you want to be able to go from every position to every position, right? So to do that, I just simply right click and drag and drop to wherever state I want to go. I want to go from position one to position two, and I also want to be able to go from position one to position three. I want to be able to go from position two to position three and two and one is already connected, right? So next thing, what we have to do, we have to create a bit more flexibility for us. So let's create here our own states. And this one we call 2, 1. Yeah, that means please go to position one. Wherever you are, go to position one. And then we create another one. This one we call 2, 2. And the third one we call 2, 3, right? And now the last step, what we have to do here, we just have to connect this message onto the right space. Yeah, so let's make here a little bit area. That means let's try to make it from the logical way. So from one, right? If I'm at position three, I want to go to position one if I press the 2, 1 method, right? So that means I have to drag and drop that here. If I'm at position two, I want to go from here to one, right? So I drag and drop this method to this side. So now we are done already with our 2, 1 method. To two, I want to go when I'm at position three, right? And to two, I want to go when I'm at position one. And the last one, 2, 3, I want to go from 2 to 3 and also from here to here. So let's track the last one there. And then we are pretty much done. If we try that now, if we press 2, 1, we are going to our position one. If I press 2, 2, we are going to position two. If I press 2, 3, we are going to position three. I can go now from every position to every position, right? So I can go from 1 to 3, I can go from 3 to 1, I can go and so on. So I think you got it. So last thing what we have to do here now is let's also connect some keyboard shortcuts, right? So let's open up a Windows key, and if you want to copy many of notes in Ventus, just select a note, then press Control C and Control V. Now we have copies of three of that guys. So our key 1, 2 we used already for our lower third and for our live input, right? So let's use now something like whatever you want. I use now set X and C on my keyboard. So I go now and say the first one is set for our first position. The next one is our X, and the third position is our C, right? And now we just simply connect to 1 to the set key, to 2 to our X key, and to 3 to our C key, right? Now let's select that, let's press set. Now we are at position 1, we are at position 2, we are at position 3, and so on. And of course we still have the flexibility, bring out and in our lower third, our live input, and so on, right? So here you have now already a simple control for a simple scene, for doing some shows, pressing, for example, going to position 3, pressing C and bringing in the live input, and here we go, right? Pressing set and bringing in our lower third, and so on. So the last thing what we will do now, we will implement a reset key or reset functionality so that we are always able to press that one key and then we are at a default position with default states, right? For example, I want to start at camera position 1 with the lower third off and with our live input off. So let's do that. So what we have to do basically, these green dots here on this axis means all these nodes with a green dot basically are connected to a animation or to a mover or yeah, have something animated, right? So what we have to do, we simply create basically a key and we tell this key whenever this key is pressed. You remember we have here our begin default state, then this begin state is triggered, or this begin method is triggered, which means then when we add camera position 3 and begin is triggered, this will jump directly to the begin default, right? And of course the same here with our live camera input, my webcam input. If we press here begin, then it's off. And the same here with our lower third. If we press here begin, then it's off. So let's do that. So to do that, we simply create a Windows key. And I assign that to R, or VR. And now we have to bring in, we can do that one by one, or we just select all our axes with the green dot. You can see now it gets a bit messy. Yeah, this is sometimes in Ventus development, you have to be carefully, or you can also group this, but I will show you more of these features in later tutorials. So for this tutorial, we just go through one by one, right? So we also can say the lower third is a bit higher. Then we bring in our live cam. I press and hold now when I select this one, my shift key, so we can arrange this a bit more nice, right? So this is here. And then we also press and hold shift and select the cam. And now we can also try to clean up the mess here a little bit, right? So set C. And now the last thing we have to do, I bring that reset key over here. I have to connect the begin state to my R key down. I have to select this one. You also can select multiple of the same nodes like this when they have the same methods with exactly the same name, then you can select multiple of the nodes and track them all together and select it to key down, right? So now let's play a little bit around. We press 1, we press 2, and we go to camera position 2, and now we press R, and now we are back at our default position, right? So now we can play around here whatever we want. We can press buttons as many as we want. Once we press R, we are always back at our default state. Now in the last part of this Ventus beginner tutorial, I will lead you through the toolbox and I will pick out a few very important and handy notes which you can use in your first projects. Let's start. Okay, in the next part, we will create some nice touch interface. Maybe not nice, but I will lead you through the process of how you easily can use interaction buttons, basically. So to start with simple thing, like always, like mostly, let's use axis. Let's use a rounded rectangle. Okay. And just let's create a kind of nice button here with size of 10 and a Y size of 4. And let's see what else we can do. Let's increase here the round size a bit. Yeah, something like that. And now let's say I want to create a touch button, right? So if somebody touch here with the mouse, or if somebody touch on a touch screen, or with another interactive device like OptiTuyo, something should happen, right? So let's do that. We are here in our interaction tab in the toolbox, and here we have now a couple of different buttons. So if we use here our touch button and drag and drop that touch button in front of our rectangle, now it's selected. And now please check here the outputs, what's happening when I move with my mouse over this rectangle. Okay, so once I move over, we get a true value from touch inside, right? I don't press any button, I just move my mouse over. We also get an event if we start the touch enter, right? If the touch enters basically this interactive area, and we also get an event when the touch leaves. So if I'm inside now and I click, then we get a single tap event, and also here the second one, the second Boolean value will be true. So touch pressed, right? Exactly. So the interactive buttons working like everything behind them are affected by this touch button. So that means if I, let's put another axis, and let's put that here, and let's use a circle. And I put that circle here. And now let's move that circle maybe bottom of our button and somewhere here. And now let's select our touch button here again. And now check again here our outputs. So once I go in, hover over the geometry, right? Everything behind the touch button, we will get exactly the same events, right? So if I go here through the middle, nothing will happen. But as soon as I hover over one of my touch buttons or interactive geometries, we will get these events. Okay, so let's use this now to make something a little bit more clever. What I want to do that if somebody presses this button, that this button maybe makes a little push down, right? So we just do that with the scaling. Let's do that with a simple mover. So we select our axis, we go in the content editor, and we search for our mover. Just let's add that mover. And let's add this mover to our, sorry, let's add the scaling factor all to our mover. And of course, by default, you remember, he's running from -1 to 1, but we just want to have a minimum value of 0.9 maybe, something like that, or even smaller, but let's keep it like that. And I want to have, I don't want that he is running all the time. So under the mode down here, you can change that. So let's change that to one shot. And exactly. And now let's press the nudge. That means now he is running from minimum to maximum and back. So let's change that. We will start at 1 and our maximum is 0.9, right? Because I want that he scale down when I press. Okay, that looks better. And now let's adjust the time a bit. Let's say 0.25, quarter of a second. And now we have already a nice little touch effect. So last thing what we have to do now, we simply have to bind this nudge method to our touch button, right? So let's press our touch button and also press shift and hold shift and select our axis, because we also want to have our mover here in our content editor, right? And now we simply drag and drop our input nudge to our touch button. Then we get a list where Ventus asks us, hey, to which event you want to connect it. So in this case, I say single tap, because I want to have it once somebody presses the left mouse button. So let's click here, and now we have exactly this effect. A couple of other touch notes are, for example, down here, our touch translation. So let's just simply do that quickly. Let's maybe move this button to the left, somewhere down here. So we keep here our touch button, which we still can click. Then let's go to another one. Let's use another axis and a rectangle. And let's put it here. And also let's bring it up, let's say 10 to 3, 10 to 4. And now let's put here just the touch translation in front to show you what this is doing. So basically like the name. Now you simply can move, yeah, basically translate everything what is behind this touch translation node, basically, right? And also here you can see, same like our touch button, we have here also a lot of different outputs, including our X and Y position, right? So, which is also very handy sometimes to create a slider or something. Then we have our touch orbit. Let me also quickly show you the touch orbit. So let's put another axis, and here for that we're using a cube. And also bring that cube a bit up. And now let's bring that touch orbit in front of our cube here. And now you can see, now we can orbiting or rotate this cube via a touch screen or our mouse in this case. And then another one is, here we have our touch paint. Yeah, with this touch paint, you just bind it here and then you simply can paint something on your screen, whatever you want. Of course, here this interactive buttons, or basically each nodes, have a lot of much more functionality, but to go through all of that during this beginner tutorial would take probably 24 or 48 hours. So as this is a beginner tutorial, I will keep it simple. And if you want to know more, and if you like this course, we are also having a Ventus masterclass where you also can learn much, much more about Ventus. So in the next part, I will cover also a very important part. That's the logic nodes, yeah, because the logic nodes are also very, very important. And I will give you an introduction into that logic nodes. Okay, next things I will show you are the logical nodes. The logic nodes are also very powerful and very important if you want to build some games, game shows, wherever you need logic, basically, right? So I opened a new scene here already and I swept to my logic tab. And here you can see you have scripting nodes where you can use, if you right click here, you can see already you can use C# or Visual Basic. Then we have here the expression nodes, which we basically will introduce right now, and many, many more, like date, timers, events, and stuff like that, right? So let's open up here our expression node. So let's right-click first, that we can see what we have. We have Boolean expression, string expressions, int expression, double, and float expression. So I will start now with the int expression. So just drag that int expression into your content editor, because it's a logical node, right? And let's make that window a bit smaller. With these expressions, they are working all exactly the same. Here on the right side in your properties, as an input, you always have the expression and you have a couple of arguments. Okay, so these arguments you can add, you can change names, whatever you want. If you click down here, then you can add here more arguments, yeah, in any kind of variable, what's possible. So for now, we leave it by default, to explain you what the expression is doing, right? So the expression over here is basically the rule. Yeah? So, and what this expression says is just A. That means this expression is taking now the argument A, right here, argument A from here, and sends it out to the result as the output, okay? So if I change now my A value here, then you can see immediately my output result also changes to exactly that A. Now what you can do, you can add a lot of mathematical, or basically any kind of mathematical expression into this expression field, right? So let's say I want to make addition A plus B, right? Maybe you want to do some educational application for some school or for whatever. And now you have already the expression, which basically gives you the result from A plus B. So let's try that. Let's put here 100 and in B we give 20. So our output is 120, right? So this is basically how an expression is working. Now let me show you a little trick. What makes your life more easy if you have to load different different sized images or movies. You remember at the beginning when we create an image or when we load an image, we have to put it somewhere on a rectangle, right? So let's use texture and just let's load some movie or some image. So we go here to the loader and we go to texture property. We load an image now. So texture property, then Ventus creates us here this texture loader. And now let me load here some image. Let's use here this landscape. And now you can see the landscape is here, but of course the aspect ratio is wrong. So you remember at the beginning, we just changed here the X and the Y values based on here the outputs on the width and the height of this picture. So what I want to do here now, I want to write an expression. Basically, I will write two expressions, which makes a little calculation for the width and height. And then it feeds directly that width and that height values into our rectangle. Okay. So let's do that. Let's create here a load expression. And let's call that width. And with this width expression, I take the A input is my width of my picture, right? So now we have that 4,288 pixels. And let's make a simple calculation. Just let's simply say I want to divide A by B. Let's do that. All right, to put here, divide A by B, A divided by B. And let's put that to 1,000. And then our output would be 4.288. Okay. Now we simply connect the size of our rectangle, the size X, to our output from the expression. And now we have already that 4.288 in the width. Now we do exactly the same with our width. So we create another float expression. Let's bring in another float expression. Let's call that height. And let's take the value from our pixel height of the image. And let's do the same. A divided by B, and we put our B value to 1,000, and our output should be 2.463, and we also bind our size Y from our rectangle to our output of the expression, and now we have already the correct aspect ratio, right? So now we can do different things. If we want to adjust the size, we just simply can adjust the size here on that front axis. What we also can do, you can also feed now this B value, because we are using in both expression the same value, the B value, that 1,000, right? Yeah, it's the same in both expression. We also can create another variable, and you can also find variables down here in your logic hub. So let's use here a float and bring in that float variable, and let's call that scaling. And here we type in 1,000, and now we simply drag and drop the values, or we bind the B value of the width and the height expression to our scaling. And once now I just have one instance where I have to change my scaling value basically, right? And with this, we also can adjust the size of that picture now. And the nice thing on that, once you created this one time, now you can change different pictures with different resolutions, right? Well, let's go here and let's maybe load now here. Let's load our girl, which has a totally different aspect ratio, right? But everything will be adjusted automatically. So for now, we covered most of the basics you need to start your own Ventus development. Of course, there's much, much more I could show you, and I can show you, and I also will show you. But to cover that in a beginner course just makes no sense. Like I said, for now, you really have all the knowledge that you can start your very first small projects. And just don't be shy. Just try out and try to get the workflow into Ventus, and just try to build your own little projects, applications, whatever you want, right? So to finish up this introduction course, I think I also have one thing I need to show you, because I think I didn't cover that. So first thing, which is very handy, you have down here, right? You have down here, you have that yellow helpline, right? That dynamic help. So, and you can see whenever you hover here over a note, you will get a kind of a quick tip or a short summary what that node is doing, right? So if I hover here over my value switch, then in that yellow box down there, you can see this node passes one of a number of input values to the output. All input values have to be of the same type, right? So this is very handy. Another very handy tip is if you want to know much more about a node, let's say you want to know something about this visual indexer, just drag it into your scene and then press F1 on your keyboard. Do that again, select this node. Make sure it's really selected, because if you see, if I select now just my content editor and I press F1, then you will get news or informations about the content editor, and you will have a direct link to the user manual, directly the part which you selected. In this case, with this link, you will get directly to the online user manual of Ventus, and they will explain you how to use the content editor. But in this case, I want to get more information about this node, about the visual indexer. So select it, press F1, and then you can see also here, you will have basically the same informations like down here. And you also have access to the user manual, plus you have also access to an example scene. Yeah, so I think all of the Ventus nodes have an example scene, which gives you then much more informations about this special node, right? So right now we are here in the visual indexer demo scene, and here you can see, click here for more. So if we click here, then basically once we click here that green button, then we will get more information here in our content editor, and then they will explain you very clearly how this specific node is working, right? So try that F1 key. It makes really sense to learn on your own Ventus. And I wish you a lot of luck and hope to see you soon again in our masterclass. Until then, bye-bye. So I hope you're all here, and I hope you all enjoyed this last 4 hours of our Ventus Basic tutorial. There's much more you can learn. There's much more we can teach. We will try to frequently create more tutorials here on YouTube. So if you want to know more, please subscribe to this channel. Give it also a like. And if you are eager to learn much more and quickly about Ventus to getting a professional, please check out our Ventus Masterclass down in the description. Until then, hope to see you again. Bye-bye.